Si ustedes van a la lista de participantes, abajo hay un icono de participantes y van a encontrar su nombre. Pongo el cursor sobre su nombre, hay rename y cambien, coloquen entre paréntesis las tres primeras letras de su país, para facilitar la identificación de ustedes. Por favor, se van a participantes, abajo en la pantalla hay un icono y encuentran sus nombres. Y ustedes se ponen el cursor sobre sus nombres, se abre un. La posibilidad de cambiar, hay more, hay rename, y se abre una pantalla donde ustedes pueden cambiar el nombre. Pongan las tres letras de su país adelante de su nombre, entre paréntesis, por favor.
Okay, gracias.
Muy buenos días a todos.
Muy buen día.
Espero que se encuentren todo bien. Bienvenido al taller virtual sobre el portal GAN, incluyendo conceptos básicos y herramientas disponibles para la planificación nacional y regional de navegación aérea. Antes de iniciar, me gustaría presentarme. Mi nombre es Jorge Armoa, soy el oficial regional de gestión de información aeronáutica y meteorología aeronáutica de la Oficina Regional Sudamericana de la OASI. Y quisiera dar algunas reglas para que nuestra reunión sea todo un éxito y sea llevado en forma ordenada. Este seminario es en español, con servicio de interpretación simultánea del español al inglés. En la parte baja del panel encontrarán una imagen de un mundo o de un globo o de un mapa mundi global, como quieran denominarlo. Y allí pueden elegir el canal en el que desean escuchar las intervenciones y presentaciones, sea español o inglés. En el momento en que ustedes intervengan o hagan alguna consulta, algún comentario, por favor, elijan el canal en la cual van a hablar o emitir sus opiniones o la pregunta. Por ejemplo, si van a intervenir en español, elijan el canal Spanish. Y si van a intervenir en inglés, por favor, elijan el canal English. Les pediría, por favor, mantener en silencio sus micrófonos y sus cámaras apagadas. Y solo activarlas en el momento de intervenir o hacer alguna consulta o algún comentario.
Joven Salvador, perdón. Mira, el mapa que está es de la 00 de ayer. Y ahorita está analizando el mapa Ubaldo. En cuanto esté, te mando un mensaje. ¿Tienes? ¿Perdón?
Por favor, pueden mantener sus micrófonos en off. Para poder intervenir, por favor, les pedimos para que la reunión sea ordenada, levanten la mano y esperen a que la palabra se les conceda. Si llevamos adelante estas reglas, la reunión lo llevaremos en forma ordenada. Y deseo que esta reunión sea un éxito y que nuestras dudas sobre el uso y aplicación del portal de las herramientas disponibles en el portal del GAM sean disipadas o respondidas y que de ahora en más podamos aplicarla en las planificaciones nacionales y regionales de navegación aérea. Good morning, everyone. My name is Jorge Armoa, ICAO San Office Regional Officer, and I will be the coordinator of the meeting today. Some rules to carry out the seminar in orderly manner. The seminar is in Spanish. It's in Spanish with simultaneous interpretation service from Spanish to English. In the lower part of the panel, you will find an image of a world, and there you can choose the channel in which you want to listen to the intervention and presentation. At the time of as the floor, choose the Spanish channel if you are going to speak in Spanish, or the English channel if you are going to speak in English. Please keep your microphone and camera turned off and silent, and only activated at the time of speech or ask some question or some comments. In order to ask the intervention, please raise your hand. In order to open the seminar, seguidamente, para dar apertura al seminario, tendremos la palabra del señor Melvin Sintrom, director regional de la Oficina Regional Norteamérica, Centroamérica y el Caribe de la OASI. Señor Sintrom, the floor is yours.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome. Welcome to this very important event. So welcome to the workshop for Global Air Navigation Plan, talking about the portals, putting the basic concepts and available tools that ICAO is now making available. In attention to the resolution of A40 of the ICAO 40th Assembly, which was held in October 2019, the states all recognized the efforts to secure and ordered development, the need for a secured and ordered development of global air navigation. When you talk about this, you understand that we're looking at harmonization of our efforts. Obviously, we're doing this within the regions, and this is why we're having this joint workshop, which is a follow-up to other workshops that we have had. You know that the Global Air Navigation Plan, the document 9750, is our highest strategic document. And now that we're revising things, we're also providing tools in the web to help the states. The important thing to understand here is that in these times of COVID, the issue not having all the personnel available, not having the ability to just move about and do the things that we want to do, the fact that aviation has decreased tremendously would lead us to think that we can sit back and breathe and take things slowly. We cannot. This is too important. This is too important. And in our region, when you talk about global air traffic management and the operational concepts, document 9854, when you talk about what's in there and what you're going to learn in this workshop, it is very important that we remain focused on what it is we have to continue to do in spite of the challenges of COVID-19. And actually, what are those challenges that are going to keep us from accomplishing the things we wish to accomplish in a strategic sense? So I hope that this workshop becomes a very valuable tool for you as you move forward and as you discuss where we want to go. For me and for my colleague, the regional director for South America, Fabio Ravani, I am very grateful that we're doing this together, because there is no other way to do this. No one state can succeed by itself. No one entity can succeed by itself. This must be done in as harmonized as possible. Harmonization is a very good word that we want, but it's a tremendously hard concept to arrive at when we look at how many different states we have, the level of development in of each state, and just a myriad of other challenges and differences within our states. But that cannot be what stops us from making the attempt to be as harmonized as possible for the benefit of our aviation in each one of the states, in the regions, and globally. So I hope that this is a very beneficial workshop for you. Please, please make sure that you utilize our personnel to address any concerns that you have. That's what the regional offices are here for, to assist you, to assist each of the member states, each of the authorities, and each in everyone involved in this, to ensuring that we have the best and as harmonized as possible global aviation system in the world. Quiero darles las gracias y las bienvenidas a todos por esta participación en este taller. Es un taller que da seguimiento a otros talleres que hemos tenido y un taller que se va a enfocar en el, en los planes nacionales global de la aviación. Entonces, es sumamente importante. Una de las cosas que necesitamos hacer es buscar mayor armonización entre las acciones que tomamos. En este taller van a aprender de algunas de las herramientas que nosotros como ASI vamos llevando a cabo para el beneficio de los estados y el beneficio de la implementación de las soluciones a estos retos que nos traen y hoy más que nunca con esta cuestión del COVID-19. Yo espero que cada uno de ustedes pueda salir de este taller mejor alientado en cuanto a las posibles soluciones de los retos que se enfrentan actualmente y buscar la manera de encontrar una armonización mayor entre los hechos y las acciones de cada uno de nuestros estados para el beneficio de la aviación en nuestras regiones y globalmente. Y con eso le doy muchas gracias. También les mando saludos desde la secretaria general, mi colega Fabio Rabani, que nosotros vemos esto tan importante en la cuestión de armonización, en la cuestión de trabajar en conjunto, de trabajar como equipo para buscar las soluciones que nos va a ayudar a todos. Entonces, con eso le doy muchas gracias a todos por su participación hoy y espero que esto sea de un gran beneficio para todos. Muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias, señor Cintrón, por sus palabras. Muchas gracias por la bienvenida. Este taller va a estar dirigida por la colega Olga de Frutos, del Buró de Navegación Aérea. Por favor, Olga, si puedes prender tu cámara, hacer la introducción. Buenos días, Olga. Muchas gracias de antemano. Te agradecemos tu participación para transferir tus conocimientos y tu experiencia en la gestión del portal del GAM y por haber sido una de las personas que se ha trabajado bastante en la preparación de este portal a fin de ir facilitando las tareas de planificación nacional y regional de los servicios de navegación aérea y las mejoras de los servicios de navegación aérea. Muchas gracias, Olga. Si deseas dirigir algunas palabras a la reunión. Adelante, Rita.
Micrófono.
Micrófono, Olga. No se te escucha.
Perdón. ¿Ahora? Tengo el audio en otro dispositivo para que me escuchen mejor. ¿Me escuchan?
Ahora sí te escuchamos.
Muy bien, pues muchísimas gracias, Jorge, muchas gracias, Mervin, y muchas gracias a ustedes por la oportunidad de estar aquí con todos ustedes una vez más. Desafortunadamente no puede ser cara a cara, pero espero que eso se solucione pronto. Aún así, es un placer, como digo, estar aquí y tratar de abordar una vez más las herramientas que hemos puesto disponibles en lo que es el portal del Plan Mundial de Navegación Aérea. So, just thank you to everybody for the opportunity of being here with you all today. It is a pleasure for me, I am sorry that it cannot be actually face to face, but I'm sure that the situation will resolve soon and we would be able to actually meet within next year, hopefully. So, as I said, this is a very important period because we have the opportunity to actually be prepared for the recovery of aviation, and the Global Air Navigation Plan is a tool that, as we will see, can help us for that. Muchas gracias otra vez. Como decía, el portal del Plan Mundial de Navegación Aérea nos va a ayudar a tomar de esta pandemia una oportunidad para estar listos cuando empiece lo que es la recuperación de los niveles de aviación a los que estábamos acostumbrados en 2019. Nada más, mi nombre es Olga de Frutos, conozco a muchos de ustedes, gracias otra vez por el apoyo y por la ayuda que siempre me prestan y para los que no me conocen, pues trabajo en el Buró de Navegación Aérea, en la OACI en Montreal, aunque ahora les saludo desde España, desde mi casa en España, así que muchísimas gracias una vez más. Up to you, Jorge, thank you.
Muchas gracias, Olga, por tus palabras. Bueno, para poner en contexto el seminario, daríamos una breve presentación sobre el contexto de la planificación de navegación aérea en las regiones Caribe y Sudamérica. Déjenme un rato. ¿Están viendo mi pantalla? Are you seeing my stock?
Sí, Jorge.
Sí, se ve muy bien.
Sí, se ve bien, bueno. Gracias.
La planificación de navegación aérea en las regiones Caribe y Sudamérica en el contexto de la sexta edición del GAM. El taller se denomina el portal del GAM, incluyendo conceptos básicos y herramientas disponibles en el portal. Quizás sea un poco ya conocido algunos slides que ustedes van a ver, pero es con la finalidad de poner en contexto la sexta edición del GAM. Esta consulta, por ejemplo, siempre es bueno repetirlo, y ya creo que mucha gente lo sabe. Sabemos a dónde vamos o a dónde queremos ir en relación a los servicios de navegación aérea. El documento 9854 de la OASI, el concepto operacional ATM global, nos presenta ese camino y cuál es el objetivo final de los servicios de navegación aérea en el contexto global y en el contexto del aumento del tráfico aéreo que cada 15 años se duplica en su número. Nos presenta, como había dicho el señor Sintrón, una visión de la OASI del sistema ATM global que sea integrado, armonizado, interfuncional y con un horizonte al 2025 o incluso más. Observamos que esta visión se había desarrollado ante el creciente tráfico del tráfico aéreo. Sin embargo, esta pandemia nos ha puesto en una situación en la que tenemos que el tráfico ha disminuido bastante, pero como ha indicado Olga, es el momento de hacer esa planificación tan importante para enfrentar los retos cuando el sistema de navegación aérea o el tráfico aéreo se restablezca cuando retornemos a esas condiciones antes de la pandemia. ¿Y qué es lo que queremos lograr? Nuevamente, el GAMOT nos dice qué es lo que se quiere lograr a nivel de sistema de navegación aérea global. Que tengamos un sistema de gestión de tráfico aéreo mundial y allí ustedes encuentran las palabras claves. Interoperable para todos los usuarios durante todas las fases del vuelo, que cumpla con los niveles de, lo más importante, la premisa para todo sistema de navegación aérea. Mantener o incrementar el nivel de seguridad operacional acordados. ¿Qué proporciones operaciones económicas óptimas? Hablamos de la sustentabilidad económica de la aviación y la sustentabilidad o que la aviación sea amigable con el medio ambiente y además respete la soberanía de los estados en el sentido de que cumpla con los requisitos de seguridad nacional. ¿Qué tenemos entonces, como ya había dicho el señor Sintrom? El GAM. El GAM para la OASI o el Plan Global de Navegación Aérea para la OASI es una herramienta de planificación de los servicios de navegación aérea que considera las prioridades mundiales en cuanto al desarrollo del tráfico aéreo, al desarrollo de la aviación, y busca dar impulso de implantaciones a las implantaciones que nos lleve a alcanzar esa visión que hemos presentado en el slide anterior. Eso es el Plan Global de Navegación Aérea. Recuerden que la filosofía del Plan Global de Navegación Aérea es trabajar en implantaciones localmente, pero pensando en forma global. ¿Cómo impacta mis planificaciones a nivel local en el contexto global de la gestión de tráfico aéreo? ¿Qué tenemos como antecedente a este plan global? Si vamos a hacer toda una historia, tenemos que rememorarnos a los años 80 del siglo pasado, de cuando se establece los FANS, los Future Air Navigation Service, el cual buscaba implementar o planificar de cómo la tecnología podía ayudar a un tráfico aéreo cada vez más creciente por mandato de la OASI. Este documento fue evolucionando hasta convertirse en un plan global de navegación aérea y surge ya el primer GAM en la década de los 90, totalmente basado en lo que es la tecnología, hasta que al inicio de este siglo, los primeros años, surgen los documentos 9854, el 9083, donde el enfoque cambia al rendimiento del sistema y no ya en la tecnología, y surge la tercera edición del GAM. La OASI prepara la tercera edición del GAM con 23 iniciativas globales de performance o iniciativas de rendimiento, y esa evolución luego en el 2013 la OASI aprueba la cuarta edición del GAM, el cual introduce la metodología de los ASBU. También considera los Key Performance Area citados en el documento 9854. Tiene cuatro áreas de mejoras de performance o PIA. Y esta era la imagen que representaba toda la metodología de los ASBU. Un dicho que realmente siempre hemos rescatado de lo que nos había indicado Olga en otros talleres era desenamorarse para enamorarse, desaprender para aprender, porque esto ya debemos de olvidarlo con la sexta edición del GAM. En la quinta edición del GAM, aprobada en el 2016, se mantienen los conceptos básicos que se habían incluido en la cuarta edición del GAM, pero se introduce lo que se denomina los bloques constitutivos básicos o Basic Building Block, en relación al cumplimiento de los SARPs o normas y métodos recomendados de la OASI relacionado a la prestación de los servicios de navegación aérea, que los estados debían tener ya cumplimentado y sobre la cual deben construir la planificación de las mejoras de navegación aérea. Los Basic Building Block es lo básico que el estado debe proveer como servicio e infraestructura para la prestación de los servicios de navegación aérea. Y está referido a las 6 áreas de navegación aérea. Mantiene el PIA, las 4 áreas de mejora de la performance. Y también ya en la cuarta edición se había introducido el concepto de hilo conductor. La sexta edición del GAM reestructura la documentación referida a los planes globales de navegación aérea. Mantiene los conceptos, pero lo organiza en 4 capas o 4 niveles. Lo cual genera lo que se llama un ASBU disgregado como módulo y elemento. Ya no observamos bloques. El gráfico anterior de las 4 áreas de mejora con módulos y elementos y bloques ya no se observa en esta edición del GAM. Sí se presentan las 4 capas o 4 niveles. El nivel estratégico global, el nivel técnico global, el nivel regional y el nivel nacional. Se enfoca en los KPI o Key Performance Improvement y los conductores. En este caso presenta 3 hilos conductores: información, operacional y el hilo conductor de CNS, tecnologías y servicio. Esta edición del GAM fue aprobado en el 2019 y la Asamblea 40 dio su ok para continuar con el trabajo de la socialización del GAM. Y lo más, digámosle, novedoso es que el GAM en su sexta edición ya no se presenta como un documento, sino como un portal. Pero este portal no solo contiene información, sino también contiene herramientas que pueden ayudar a los estados y a las regiones para facilitar la planificación regional y nacional de los sistemas de navegación aérea. ¿Qué se hizo a nivel de regional en relación a la socialización de la sexta edición del GAM? El GREPECAS, el Grupo de Planificación y Ejecución de las Regiones Caribe y Sudamérica, ha tomado este documento y ha sugerido algunas acciones a los estados mediante conclusiones tomadas en la última reunión del Comité de Revisión de Programas y Proyectos del GREPECAS. Así tenemos la conclusión CRPP 05/03, que habla del uso del nuevo portal del GAM de la OASI, en donde menciona que la Secretaría ponga el máximo empeño de socializar con los estados y realice otras reuniones o seminarios a fin de que los estados se familiaricen con el uso del portal del GAM y el uso de las herramientas. Además, en la conclusión CRPP 504, en donde el GREPECAS sugiere a los estados y a la Secretaría realizar un análisis de brecha del cumplimiento con la sexta edición del GAM, considerando el estatus actual de las prestaciones de los servicios de navegación aérea en la región y en los estados. Y la conclusión CRPP 0510, que la Secretaría, en forma conjunta con los estados, comiencen el desarrollo del volumen 3 del Plan Regional de Navegación Aérea Electrónica y soporte a los estados en la preparación de sus planes nacionales de navegación aérea alineada a la sexta edición del GAM. ¿Cuáles fueron las acciones tomadas por la Secretaría en relación a estas conclusiones? A nivel SAM, a nivel de Sudamérica, la región sudamericana, se ha realizado un taller sobre la identificación e implantación de indicadores de desempeño de los sistemas de navegación aérea del 5 al 9 de agosto del 2019, donde tuvimos el honor de que Olga nos acompañe y sea la instructora de este taller. La Secretaría también proveyó asistencia técnica a los estados de Panamá y Perú para la preparación de sus planes nacionales de navegación aérea alineada a la sexta edición del GAM. Evian, ¿pasó la palabra?
Good morning to everybody. I don't know if you can hear me. I'm speaking in English, but I didn't switch channels. I wanted just to make a test to see if everybody was listening accordingly. Am I going out okay?
Yes, it is. Sí, afirmativo.
Okay, so good morning to everybody. My name is Adrian Mendez, and I am the ICAO NAC ATM and SAR Regional Officer. And I wanted to provide just, introduction from our perspective before going to explain what we have done so far with regards to the Secretariat's action. For the ICAO NAC office, there are three things that are important that we hope starting today. And the first part is a full and realistic transition to a performance-based environment. No performance with regards to time or level of implementation, but a realistic transition to a full performance-based environment for a region. The second one is to embrace the air navigation plan as the sole reference or the main reference for air navigation planning and implementation. So in the past, the CAR region, the non-CAR regions had different documents as a reference for air navigation planning. So we would like now to make the air navigation plan as the sole document for the guidance with regards to implementation, as Jorge was mentioning, moving to the volume 3, that requires a lot of work. And because of the two previous points that I mentioned, we are looking for more than an harmonization, a full integration between the CAR and the SAM regions, that we could really achieve something in which we are working together in line with what our regional director, Mrs. Sintron, mentioned in the opening remarks. So with regards to the CAR region for the Secretariat actions, we held some preliminary work internally within ICAO, with the headquarters and the NAC regional office, with the support from Olga as well. The information you're gonna receive today is part of that. And we held a ICAO workshop on the new GAM version in February 2020. And as a consequence, we started working with a gradual review of the work plan of the navigation or any working group that is the regional mechanism that we use for the implementation of air navigation to align them with the sixth version of the GAM. However, there's a little bit of, let's say, a pause there, because we needed this type of events where we could provide more information regarding the tools that we are going to be using as a reference for implementation. So that's about it with regards to the actions from the CAR region. And I get back to Jorge for the continue the presentation. Thank you.
Muchas gracias, Edian. En relación a la preparación del volumen 3, en este punto es importante recordar la recomendación, la 13ª Conferencia de Navegación Aérea, la recomendación 4.3/1, literal D, en donde la 13ª Conferencia de Navegación Aérea recomendaba a los estados y a las regiones que en la preparación del volumen 3 del Plan Regional de Navegación Aérea sea considerada la inclusión o la preparación de las mismas considerando el método de los 6 pasos enunciado en el documento 9883 de la OASI. La Secretaría del Repecas, mediante puntos focales en ambas oficinas, acompañó la preparación de esta plantilla del volumen 3 de los planes regionales de navegación aérea, tarea liderada por el Buró de Navegación Aérea de la OASI. Debido a la coyuntura actual, algunos trabajos fueron se hizo un stop al trabajo de la preparación de la misma. Sin embargo, hay un compromiso de las regiones Caribe y Sudamérica de ser parte de un proyecto piloto para la implantación electrónica de la plantilla del volumen 3 de los planes regionales de navegación aérea. En ese contexto, continuamos los trabajos y nos pareció muy importante la realización de este taller para facilitar a los estados, a los planificadores de los estados, y darle una mejor comprensión a estos planificadores sobre el uso y aplicación de las herramientas que están disponibles en el portal del GAM. En ese sentido, que hemos contactado con el Buró de Navegación Aérea y Olga ha accedido gentilmente a brindarnos este taller para un poco darnos instrucción sobre la aplicación de estas herramientas. Dicho esto, la idea era ponerlos en contexto de la situación actual o del estatus actual de la planificación de navegación aérea en las regiones Caribe y Sudamérica. Pasaría la palabra a Olga de Frutos para darnos toda la instrucción sobre el uso y aplicación de las herramientas del portal de Robán del Plan Global de Navegación Aérea, sexta edición. Olga, the floor is yours. Tu micrófono, Olga.
Gracias, Jorge. Thank you, Jorge. So I am going to speak in English and I will actually just reply in Spanish if I can. You know me that sometimes I just lose the words in Spanish, although I'm from Spain. But I will try to reply in Spain if the question is asked in Spanish to me. So I would like this session to be a very interactive session. I'm going to dump off you a lot of information, okay? You know me, so it's going to be like a very concentrated kind of working session. So what I would suggest is that if you have any doubt as we go through the GAM portal, you just raise your hand and you just ask the question and don't wait for me to go on and go on. Now, before asking the question, it would be nice if you could please introduce yourself so that we know where you are from, and then just do the question, okay? So I'm going to try to share my screen. Let me see. Okay. Can you see my screen?
Sí.
Sí, hola.
Okay. Gracias. Thank you. So the first question that I get actually when we are going to talk about the GAM portal is a very important one, and is, Olga, how do we find the GAM portal? That's, you know, internet is huge. So that's a very good point. So my reply is always the same one, which is what I do usually when I cannot find something, at least to Google it. So you go to Google and you put GAM portal. And the first link that you will usually get, it will say ICAO Global Navigation Plan. So you will click there and it will actually get you to the official website of ICAO, okay? And then you will see here, like you can have previous editions of the GAM, which are actually like hard copies. So you will find all the PDFs here and you will find other information. Now in the official website, the GAM is not part of the official website because of obvious reasons, like behind the portal, there is a database that we will talk about. So in order to build this portal, we had to remove it from the official website. However, in order for people to find this GAM portal, what we did is in the official website, we included the link to the GAM portal. So where you find Global Air Navigation Plan 6th edition, you will find here English version, then you can click and then you will go to the GAM portal. Why does it say English version? Is because the portal, it is actually only in English for the moment being. There is only one part that is in all ICAO languages, and it's the one that I will highlight just now. So as we have already said, as Jorge has very well explained, the previous versions of the GAM, they were PDF, they were hard copy, you know, they were a paper where anybody can write anything. So by actually putting it into the GAM portal, we had to implement lots of structure to it and lots of consistency because computers do not understand about inconsistency. So that will act, that has actually driven us to make some small changes, but they are not major, as I would say. Like, it is not different, basically. It's not a big difference from the 5th edition of the GAM, okay? Now, one of the differences that we did implement is basically we implemented this multi-layer structure of the GAM. And why did we do that? So if you go to the previous editions of the GAM, you will see actually that it was like a very small kind of document where it actually had lots of appendixes that were huge. Now, these appendixes are basically where all the technical content was. So what we did is we moved this technical content into the global technical level of the GAM, and we kept the strategy at a global strategic level. We wrote it in a more kind of high level because our objective was actually to differentiate between the audiences of the global strategic level and the global technical level. So the global strategic level is basically directed to the director generals and all these people that actually have to define which is the strategy of their navigation system in each of our states. While the global technical level, it's actually the tool that will help the planners, the designers, us, you know, in order to plan which is how do we want to modernize our air navigation system. Then it was very important for us actually to include here the regional and the national level, because without consistency, we will not get anything. Now, I will actually start by saying by the national level and I will go up, okay, and we will see why. So at the national level, who is responsible for the national level? You are responsible for the national level. ICAO or the regional offices, we are not responsible for the national level. It is up to you to decide if you want to build an airport, if you want to build another runway, if you want to divide an FIR in one way or another one. The national level, it is actually your responsibility, okay? And this would be translated actually into the regional level. Now, what is ICAO doing in terms of a national level? ICAO, what it does, it provides support to you in order for you to plan your air navigation, the modernization of your air navigation system in a very kind of efficient way. Now, in order to do so, what we are doing is basically two things. We are working on a template, okay? And, you know, everybody's saying, yes, Olga, you said that already a year ago. Where is that template? We actually have a template, but we have not validated yet. We have asked some states to actually use the template and tell us how stupid we are. We have found some flaws in the template. Like, for instance, when you talk about the scope of the global, in this scale of the National Air Navigation Plan, is huge, you know? It links to the budget, which is the budget that you plan for the next year. It links to the safety and navigation plan. Aviation plan, national aviation plan. It links to which is the maintenance of the systems that you are going to have in place. So all this kind of scope of the national navigation plan is what is actually challenging us in developing this kind of template. But I hope that maximum by, if not by next year, before the next air assembly, this will be one of the big deliverables of the next edition of the GAMP. As part of the last conference, we had a paper from the secretariat where basically a group of experts came with a checklist of things that need to be considered when you are performing a cost-benefit analysis for the implementation of a new operational improvement. So this checklist, it is basically what you have there here in this link, okay? So we have the checklist and we have the template that this says coming soon, as I said. Now, why did I say that this kind of national responsibility will actually be reflected at the regional level? As Jorge and Etienne were actually saying, for us, the CARSAM plan, it is actually a very important plan because it actually helps us, as Mervyn was saying, to actually achieve this global harmonization that is so important in the aviation system. Now, in order to achieve that, we need to have a common plan. And this, in your case, is the CARSAM. So the CARSAM was basically formed of two volumes before. We had the basic volume and we had the phased. So in the basic, we had very stable kind of documents. So like which are the international airports, which are the borders of the FIRs and things like that. And in the facet, we have which are the services and the services that are and facilities that are basically available in each of these places. No. So if you have an ILS, which is the category of the runway, things like that, that are more kind of dynamic. Now, volume one and volume two, basically when we move in 2016, which was basically when we move in the CARSAM region from the old template to the new template, okay? The new template has three volumes, volume one, volume two, and volume three. So volume one is basically the same thing as we had in the previous basic. So it is the list of international aerodromes that you have in your states. It is the list of FIRs that you have in the states. It is the list of the search and rescue regions that you have in your state. Now, volume two is linked to the facilities and the services that you actually have available or you put available for international civil aviation in this, in all of these airports, FIRs, et cetera, et cetera. Now, I hope you are paying attention that I'm not saying that ICAO is...
No, va a terminar hasta las dos, es un curso. Uh-huh. Pero te comento rápidamente, mira, de los niveles ya de tropopausa 700 los puedes procesar.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, thank you. So as I was saying, you know, as volume one and volume two, it is not ICAO who is telling the states, excuse me, you have to build me an airport in Madrid or you have to build me an airport in Peru, in Lima, or you have to build me an airport in Mexico DF. It is not ICAO who is saying that. It is actually the states. So volume one and volume two are just a recopilation of what the states are planning to do in terms of international civil aviation in their navigation system. Now, volume three, it is not different. Without the states going to a performance-based approach, as Etienne was saying, we will never have a volume three, as Jorge was saying. And it is not ICAO who is going to tell you what you have to do. It is ICAO who is actually supporting you to achieve a very efficient modernization of your air navigation system through volume three. Now, volume three, again, it is not ICAO who is going to tell you what you have to do. You have to perform your own analysis in order to tell ICAO which your plans are in terms of modernizing your air navigation system. Now, once we get all this input, like for instance, I'm planning to implement ATFM in these FIRs, that will be reflected. So the FIRs will be in volume one, ATFM will be in volume three. It's not different to what we have to, today. No responsibility will change. The only difference is that instead of getting obsessed with the solution, instead of just building an airport without having a need to build an airport, we are now trying to analyze what do we need in order to invest our available resources as best as we can. Is this clear? Because it is actually very important. Zooms up. I cannot see anybody, so it's a bit difficult. Okay.
That's fine for us.
Good. Thank you. Thank you for that. So this is very, very important in order for us to build this system. So the regional navigation plan, basically the old ones, the basic and the basic, they were also PDF, okay? And in 2016, we actually moved to this new template. Now we moved in a kind of PDF old traditional way. Now what we are missing is to actually take all this input and build the portal of the regional navigation plans. And that's what we are working on. And we hope that by next year, we actually have this system available so that you can actually go into the system, log in as your state, propose any proposal for amendment, and actually use the tool of the regional air navigation plan to for your own national air navigation planning. Now, then we have two levels at a global level. We have the global technical level and we have the global strategic level. So I will start with the global strategic level, okay? And then we will move to the global technical level. So as you can see, I have been using this interactive pyramid, but to be honest, I'm not a fan of the pyramid. I think it looks very cool, you know, from an IT perspective, but I think it's actually more practical to use these tags that you have at the top of the CAMP portal website. So I'm going to use these tags from now on, okay? So the global strategic level, basically, if you click in it, you will see that it is a global, it is an electronic document. There is no database behind it, and there will never be a database behind the global strategic level. It's just a document where we basically lay out what is the strategy that we want to implement at a global level in terms of air navigation, as Mervy was saying. So it has a series of chapters, okay? It has an executive summary too, for, you know, like directors usually do not have time to spend not even like maybe 15 minutes reading like the whole document. So we prepare like an executive summary that consists of maybe 2-3 pages where they can actually scroll through it and have an idea of what where the international community wants to go in terms of air navigation. Then it has an introduction, which basically tells you what is the CAMP, how the CAMP is maintained, which is very important. This is also important to think about it in terms of a national level, okay? How is your plan going to be maintained? What is your plan? Which is the relationship of your plan with other kind of documents that you have in your state? I was saying before, like budget, maintenance of systems, plans, and things like that that you have. The relationship with other plans that you could have, okay, in your system. Then it has another chapter that talks about roles and responsibilities. The most important thing when you are actually planning the modernization of, oops, yes.
De ¿sí? México está alzando la mano, Víctor Alonso.
Víctor, go ahead, please. Víctor. I cannot hear you, but I'm not sure it's just me or
Víctor Alonso.
Maybe it was a mistake. Okay, Víctor, if you have a question, just please, as soon as you can unmute yourself and just interrupt me, that would be fine, okay? So just unmute yourself whenever you can and just ask the question. Thank you. So then, as I was saying...
Acaba de confirmar que fue por error.
Okay, gracias. Thank you. So then, as in addition to the introduction, we have the roles and responsibilities, and as I was saying, when people ask me, Olga, what, you know, like I'm interested in doing developing my national air navigation plan, which is the first step. The first step to any development of the national air navigation plan is to clearly identify the roles and responsibilities of that plan. Who are the people that would need to be involved in the implementation of the plan? Because those people have actually to be represented in the committee that will be in charge of developing the national air navigation plan. If your plan will cover the military community, you need to have the military represented in the committee. If your plan is going to include the unmanned aircraft system, you need to have that community represented in the committee. Why? Because if you do not involve all the stakeholders that will actually be responsible for the implementation of the plan since the beginning, you will not get the buy-in from those stakeholders, and therefore the plan might actually never be implemented, which would be a pity after all the effort that you would be putting in building the plan. So very important to define the roles and responsibilities when you are developing the National Air Navigation Plan, and that's what we did at a global level in the strategic level of the Global Air Navigation Plan. Important too, to basically identify which are the challenges and opportunities that you are facing. Well, now we are facing a huge challenge in aviation that we never thought about it. And it's the fear of people to travel in addition to a pandemic. So different kind of challenges will have different kind of solutions. And everybody that is involved in the roles and responsibilities will have a role in actually addressing these challenges and making them an opportunity. So in terms of challenges, what we envision in the camp is the continuing support of social well-being worldwide. Aviation employs lots of people in the world directly and indirectly, okay, so this is very important to be noted in your strategy of the GAMP to make it basically linked to the developing plan of your state and to the transport plan that probably your states also have. So this is very important to have as, you know, a challenge or an opportunity that you actually would like to consider in your national navigation plan. Accommodation of increasing demands and new types of demands. So obviously the demand is not increasing nowadays. However, there are new types of demands that they are coming and they are actually here and they are going to be more feasible. I believe actually, and this is my personal opinion, that with this crisis, actually the new entrants will have an even bigger role within the aviation system, bringing new types of aviation, where we basically maybe move from a commercial aviation to a different kind of aviation. Use of advanced technologies. It is now time to actually cut costs And how to cut the cost is basically through using technologies that are more efficient. We will have now systems that we might not be working for months or years, and we have to see how they will actually respond whenever we start using them. We hope they respond well, but we also may think that, you know, it is an opportunity for us to modernize those systems. So we are going to have new technology over there available to be used for aviation. Human capability and capacity, despite we are going to use more modern systems, we still depend on humans in the system. And this is very important to consider when we are modernizing the navigation system. Then emerging new and adapted business models. And I would say these new entrants, they actually have these different business models. I maybe like some of you have seen this man flying these months because they are more than one, or these flying cars, which actually I would love to fly one of them before I retire. So these are the challenges and opportunities that we basically see in aviation. In the Global Air Navigation Plan. This is important basically to identify in your own systems. The vision, where do you want to go? Which is the system that you envision for your state? This is very important. This is actually very important because without a vision, you are going everywhere and you are going nowhere. So where do you want to go? It doesn't need to be a huge strategy. Like here is a one-page vision. Like I want to achieve a system that is environmentally friendly, that will not cause harm, that it will help social development. So all these things, you basically have to put them in your own vision. Now your vision should be performance driven. So that's what I talk about environment, about delay, about flexibility. I did not say I'm going to have 30 airports, I'm going to build 20 new runways. I did not say that. I said, I'm going to reduce the delay. Let's leave to the technical people how am I going to do that, okay? So the performance ambitions, as Jorge was saying, we have 11 key performance areas that were defined in document 9854 on the global ATM operational concept of how we know him, the GATMOC. And they were actually further elaborated in the document for performance management, which is actually document 9883, ICAO document 9883, which basically further develops how to plan managing performance. So you all have heard me talking about this six-step method. So it's basically explained in that document. Now these 11 key performance areas are, for instance, we have safety, access and equity. There are some that are more visible than others. So security, safety, and environment, they are usually very, very visible to the public. There are others that are less visible, like for instance, delays, which is only visible to the people that actually travel, you know, so capacity or predictability. Only the people that travel, they actually care to arrive on time. Like my grandpa does not travel, so he doesn't really care if I arrive on time or not. He does care when he hears noise of an aircraft going over my village. So there are some KPIs that are more important than others that are more, not more important, but they are more visible to the public, okay? From a planning perspective, for all of us, actually interoperability, which has no visibility whatsoever, is one of the most important ones, okay? So all of them are equally important, but some of them are more visible than others. And what we did is we could not establish targets. That's the real, we were not capable of extracting targets, because to basically define targets, you need to understand which is the baseline that you have in the global air navigation system. But we have not measured performance yet, or not as much indicators as we want. So we could not establish targets that we want to achieve in 2040. What we could is actually to provide basically this statement. So where do we want to go? What do we want to achieve in terms of these areas by 2040? So we call these statements, or these qualitative kind of targets or objectives, we call them performance ambitions. So you will have here like the performance ambition in each of the 11 key performance areas. You will have some more explanation if you click in each of the areas above. Now, how to achieve these performance ambitions? How are we going to achieve these performance ambitions? So you need to have a strategy, a technical strategy on how do you plan to do that, no? And this is where basically the tools that we will see in the technical level will actually help you to identify which is your conceptual roadmap, which is the roadmap that you have to implement in order to achieve the performance ambition and the vision that you will state in your national air navigation plan. So our conceptual roadmap, because we are not implementing systems at a global level, we are just implementing concepts. We basically have four steps. And you have outlined here, basically the opportunities and challenges of each of these steps. So evolutionary step 1, 2, 3, and 4. You can actually read them. I find they are quite interesting, but one of the big things that we envision in this conceptual roadmap is the increasing use of information. So information is becoming key to actually achieve the performance ambitions that we have in the vision of the Global Air Navigation Plan. So every time more and more data, we have more and more data available. We have tools to actually process that data to make it information and to have or to make better informed decisions. And this is the goal of all these conceptual roadmap that you have in the strategic level. Now, from concept operations, just states that, again, you know, this is a structured approach, as Melvin was saying, like we all have a different mom and a different dad, and we are all different. Now, we all evolve at a different pace, but we all need to evolve. Now, the GAMP, basically, through its structured approach, different performance, basically allows this scalability, which is so needed or so necessary within the global at a global level in their navigation system. It highlights then the importance again of harmonizing the global, the regional, and the national level, because as I was saying, actually everything starts with the national level. It is you who actually start the national level, and that's reflected into the regional levels, and that's reflected into the global level. And then you have basically some acronyms, abbreviations, and glossary. So this is the strategic level of the GAMP, and you should have your own strategy at the national level. You can just take the index that we have here and just try to develop your own strategy at the national level, which is basically should follow something like that. And we will see now how this is translated into the technical level. Any questions? No, I forgot to say that if you want it in Spanish, in Espanol, you have to basically just click here in the top right side of the template, and then you will have all the strategy in Spanish. So this is the only part that is actually available in the 7 ICAO languages. And if you want it to print it, then you can click here in the PDF, and it will generate a PDF that then you can download and print. Okay. So let's move to the technical level, which is the more, I find the more interesting one, but there are different opinions. So there are basically, the technical level consists basically of two global frameworks, two global technical frameworks that Jorge already talked about it. The basic building block framework, or BBBs, or how my boss called them 3Bs, but basically like most of the people refer to them as the BBBs, the basic building blocks. And we have the ASBUS that you are all familiar with them, the Aviation System Block Upgrades framework. Now, these two frameworks, they are two different frameworks actually on purpose, because they are very different on nature. It is true that with time people say, oh yes, but in the future the ASBUS will become mandatory and therefore will be part of the basic building block framework. That is true. But nowadays, the basic building blocks are basically based on ICAO provisions, on the SHAs, on the standards that we have in the ICAO annexes of air navigation. So basically we have the BBBs. You have an introduction there. I'm not going to read it all. Now we'll talk briefly about how the BBB verification is. But we basically have three areas on the BBBs. So we have the meteorological information area. We have the aeronautical information area, the search and rescue, the air traffic management, the aerodromes operation. And there is another area that is actually embedded in the ASPUS, but it doesn't appear there as an independent one, that is communications, navigations, and surveillance. So these are the six areas that we have of on the BBBs, on the basic building block framework. And you know, they are not areas that we just invent or we decide, okay, so this area, yes, this area, no, or something like that. No, actually these areas are the same areas that you have in volume one and volume two of the CARSAM plan. And that's not a coincidence, okay? This is done on purpose. So why did we have the BBBs? The BBBs is nothing new. We included the BBBs in the global technical level of the GAMP in order to align the global level with the technical level. Okay, so if you go to the regional plans, you will see there that you say under the part of aerodrome operations, you will say you have to provide the services according to Annex 14 and PAN SAGA. So basically you go here to aerodrome operations and you will see that these are the basic services that you need to provide as part of that statement that is in the regional navigation plans. Now, each of these areas of the BBBs basically consist on a series of blocks of modules, of BBB modules, okay? So for instance, in the Met area, we have the Aerodrome Meteorological Office, we have the Meteorological Watch Office and the Global Regional Centers. So if a state is responsible for an FIR, it will have,
tengo pregunta,
to have a meter. Oops, yes.
Sí, me gustaría aclarar si los BBB son requisitos.
Sí. Son,
por eso es válido aclararlo para que lo tengan bien clarito, ¿no?
Los BBB, gracias, son requerimientos, ¿vale? Uh-huh. Y la forma en la que nosotros hicimos estos diagramas, básicamente es, literalmente, en este caso de Meteorology, cogimos el anexo 3, que es el anexo de meteorología de la BACI, y subrayamos todos los shall que había en ese anexo, ¿vale? Si tú vas y haces eso, vas a ver que algunos de los shall son básicamente shall para establecer un marco legal, que es lo que va ligado a lo que es el USOAP y todo el oversight del servicio, ¿vale? ¿Vale? Hay algunos shall que van ligados al establecimiento del marco legal, ¿vale? Para la validez del anexo.
¿Puedes explicar un poquito el shall? Shall es en inglés que estábamos hablando, ¿no?
Sí. Sí. Gracias. A ver, entonces, en los anexos de la ACI hay dos tipos de requerimientos. Bueno, hay un requerimiento, de hecho, que son lo que yo llamo los shall, ¿vale? No sé cómo se traduce al español, Jorge o alguien.
Debe o debería.
Debe
o debería. Debe. Sí.
Vale, debe. Debe es el shall, ¿vale? Que yo me estaba refiriendo. Y luego hay otro tipo de no son requerimientos, pero son recomendaciones, que yo supongo que son los debería, ¿vale? Que son los should. Entonces son debe y debería. En el caso de los BBBs, tenemos lo que es los debe, que son requerimientos de obligado cumplimiento. Si un Estado no cumple esos requerimientos, tiene que hacer, o sea, que tiene que mandar a la ACI una diferencia diciendo yo difiero de este requerimiento que se ha acordado en el anexo 3. ¿Queda claro? Entonces, algunos de los DBS que hay en el anexo 3 están ligados a lo que es el establecimiento del marco legal para la validez de la de los requerimientos que hay en el anexo 3. Pero otros muchos están ligados.
Hay otra pregunta de Brasil. David.
Okay, thank you, David from Brazil. Olga, please consider your knowledge about the BBB. My question is, how many states already overcame the concept of BBB, especially in the South America?
Well, unfortunately, I am not in the region. I mean, I'm not in the South American office, and probably like my South American friends can actually reply to that better. However, as I said, this is a mandatory requirement. So I believe that all of the states who have not actually filed a different against the ICAO standards, they are actually in compliance with Annex 3 or the different annexes within ICAO. But I will let my friends in the Lima office to reply to that, maybe.
I did this question just to be clear, because I think that it's going to be important for us in the South America to know the level of the BBB in order to, in the future, to update our regional plan.
Olga,
yeah.
Francisco.
Creo
que la idea de los estados es que deben tomar esto como mandatorio. ¿No? Son módulos básicos que necesitamos para avanzar para otros módulos, ¿no? De la implantación CNSATM. Entonces, se debe tomar que esos ya deberían estar. En verdad, este es el concepto. Se debería estar con este básico ya estructurado, funcionando, deben estar y avanzar con sus planes para los para los upgrades, para la evolución que está planteada en el GAMP y en los módulos ASBO.
Sí, gracias, Francisco. ¿Sí?
Olga, con relación a la intervención de Brasil, los Basic Building Blocks son mandatorios y no es que uno, si no va a cumplirlo, debe reportar la diferencia. O sea, la diferencia,
tienes que reportar la diferencia.
No le exime del cumplimiento. Tienes que reportar la diferencia de este requerimiento mandatorio cuando no sea aplicable al Estado. Cuando no sea aplicable al Estado. Si es aplicable al Estado, sí. Si es aplicable al Estado, vale la redundancia, no aplica el reporte de una diferencia. En todo caso, el no cumplimiento se convierte en una deficiencia de navegación aérea. Eso hay que tenerlo bien en claro. La comunicación de la diferencia de estos requerimientos mandatorios que se encuentran en los anexos, los que tú dices, lo que son shall, Es solamente cuando este requerimiento no aplica al Estado por A o B condiciones.
Por ejemplo,
si aplica.
Si un Estado tiene un FIR, ¿vale? Debajo de su responsabilidad, tiene el deber de tener una Meteorological Watch Office y esta oficina tiene el deber de proveer estos servicios aquí. Ahora, si yo no tengo un FIR, pues obviamente no tengo este requerimiento.
No aplica.
Porque este requerimiento no va aplica. Ligado a la responsabilidad de tener un FIR, o se llama IFR en español.
Sí, Flight Information Region, o región de información de vuelo.
A una región de información de vuelo debajo de mi responsabilidad. Eso es a lo que te refieres, José.
Sí. Así mismo. Vale. Así mismo. Okay. Por ejemplo, un caso bien típico es Centroamérica. Centroamérica. Todo es el AFIR, por ejemplo, los estados de Costa Rica, Nicaragua, Belice, Guatemala, no tienen una oficina de vigilancia meteorológica. Por tanto, ellos deben reportar una diferencia con respecto al trabajo de la Meteorological Watch Office, porque no tienen esa responsabilidad, no aplica al estado. Sin embargo, sí tienen Aeródromo Meteorological Office, eso sí porque es obligatorio, y si no, sí. Si no lo están cumpliendo, no los exime de esa responsabilidad la comunicación de una diferencia. O sea, no es aplicable en ese caso enviar una diferencia. Si no lo están aplicando, eso automáticamente se convierte en una deficiencia.
Correcto.
Okay. Pero si en el caso ahora de la pandemia, por ejemplo, si hay una diferencia que no necesariamente tiene que ser una deficiencia.
Hay algunas, en el caso de la pandemia hubo un reporte de la OACI en la que se permitió algunas diferencias con respecto a los estándares, pero eso es bajo las circunstancias en las que se estaban viviendo y que de una forma controlada.
Sí, correcto.
No sé cuál es el estado de la implementación de ese tipo en la CARSAM region, pero no es solo no aplico la diferencia porque hay una pandemia, sino que se tiene que tener responsabilidad en la aplicación de un requerimiento diferente al que tenemos en los anexos. Y obviamente de forma temporal.
Olga, en ese sentido, en cuanto en el contexto de la pandemia, cuando hay degradación de los servicios debido a la situación de la pandemia, lo correcto es aplicar los planes de contingencia que debe existir para cada área. No es la idea transmitir diferencias por mientras dure la pandemia, sino en caso de que por motivos de salud, por el tema de afectación de personal o la idea aplicada de teletrabajo se aplique y se extienda a algunas oficinas y exista problema de sistema, en ese caso se aplican los planes de contingencias para cada área. Y no comunicar una diferencia, y esos planes de contingencia deben estar bien previstos para todas las áreas en los estados, y si fuese necesario, en caso de que haya una degradación muy fuerte, transmitirlo, comunicarlo a la comunidad internacional de la aviación mediante los NOTAN u otras informaciones de los servicios de información aeronáutica.
Ok. Gracias, Jorge. Entonces, So continuing, what does, and this actually, I think it replies the next question that we have in the chat. What the PPP does in each of this area, it states basically the basic services or the essential service that we need to provide in order to fulfill the requirements that are established in the Chicago Convention and the annexes, and which are the units that are responsible for the implementation of those essential services. Now, it also provides you information on which are actually the end users of those services. So when we were developing this schema, we were actually curious of who were the end users of these services. So we linked them to the end users. And as I said, we actually differentiate between the different types of communications, navigations, and surveillance infrastructure that it shall be used for the provision of those services. So some services are services that you just publish in a PDF in a website, okay? Like for instance, the climatological information, and that's why it has a dash arrow. While others, like for instance, the SIGMET, are reports that it actually needs to be provided according to Annex 3 through dedicated aviation infrastructures. So that's basically what you have here. Now, people have asked us why we haven't provided more details in terms of which is this CNS dedicated aviation infrastructure that could be used for the provision of the services. So we took the task for the future to basically, instead of just putting generic dedicated infrastructure versus not dedicated infrastructure, to basically state if it can be like ADS-B or it can be Multilat or any other kind of information, of technology that can be used for the provision of those services. And what it actually points out in reference to the question that we had in the chat is basically where in Annex 3 the requirement to provide these basic services, it is established. So you have the reference for each of the areas of these essential services in the basic building blocks. And it actually also lists which are the documents that ICAO has developed that can help the people to implement those services. So these are reference to ICAO documents, to guidance material that it actually would help the people to implement these essential services that we listed in each of the areas. Then you have just a reference to the name of each of these documents that we mentioned. So you have this for the five areas that I was talking about. Although the one that is less developed is the CNS area, and we took the task to do that in the future. Another question that we get quite often when we present these BBBs, say, Olga, this is very nice, but you know, it is just a PDF. Because when we go to the ASBUS and everybody sees the portal and you can play with it, you can develop tools and things like that, and say, wow, you know, like, why don't we do the same thing with the BBB? So we got the task actually to do this, okay? And we will develop a portal whenever we have IT resources available to do so for the BBBs, where you will actually click each of these boxes and you will go directly to the reference within the annex, where actually the mandatory or the requirement, the mandatory provision of that service is established. Another question that we got very often is like, okay, Olga, but this is the BBBs. And then people say, okay, but then we have the USO app, we have the BBBs, we have the regional plans. At the beginning of the PDF of the BBBs, you will basically find a text that talks about BBB verification. Now, what is this? There are three different kind of concepts here. One is the provision of the service, the implementation of the service. So usually this service has to be provided by air navigation service providers. They need a med provider, an aeronautical information provider, an ATM provider, but it's an air navigation service provider who usually basically provides or implements the service. It is the authority of the state who actually oversees the provision of this service. So this is two basically very different concepts. In the USO app, okay, in the USO app audit framework of ICAO, we basically have the PQs or the protocol questions. So these questions, ICAO makes these questions to the authority in order to understand which is the capability that the authority has to oversee the service as it is implemented by the ANSP, by the Air Navigation Service Provider. Now, the implementation of the service, it is usually done by the Air Navigation Service Providers, and it is usually reflected in the regional air navigation plans. That is why we have in ICAO another process that we call the deficiencies against their navigation plans. The deficiencies against their navigation plans are deficiencies against the implementation of these services on their navigation system. Okay? They are not related to the oversight of those services, but to the implementation of the service. That's why we have a relation, that's true, between the PQs, the protocol questions in the program to basically oversee the capability of the state to oversee the service. And we have a link to basically these deficiencies that we have in their navigation plan, or what we have that the states have committed to implement in terms of essential services for international civil aviation. Now, the good news is that we work in that link. That is something that people were requesting us. And we are going to provide this link in the High Level Safety Conference that was scheduled for May of next year. But Council decided just last week that conference could not take place due to the pandemic. So it has moved all the conference that will happen in ICAO to the end of next year, to October. Now, the High Level Safety Conference will therefore take place together with all the conferences that were planned for this year: security, facilitation, recovery from the pandemic, et cetera, et cetera, in October of next year. So in October of next year, if this Omnibus conference that has been baptized with that name, the Omnibus conference, we will basically present an information paper on which have been the developments within the Global Air Navigation Plan. And one of the developments, as I said, basically provides the link between the BBBs and the protocol questions in the audit program of ICAO. So you will have here like something like this that links like the BBBs with all the protocol questions. So this is what I have for you in terms of the BBBs. And then we will go back. Now the BBBs, as we were saying, they are requirements, they are DEVEN, they are mandatory. Now the ASBUS, they are not mandatory, okay? The ASBUS is a menu of best practices on how I can modernize my air navigation system. So if we go to the ASBUS here, and it usually takes time to load, okay? Because as I said, the ASBUS is not a PDF anymore. It is actually a portal that is linked to a database that is supporting all these interactive links that we do with the program, because computers do not understand about inconsistencies. So we have the ASBUS, we have the ASBUS framework, and we have the performance framework. So the performance framework is the way in which we have to use the ASBUS framework. So I am going to go through the ASBUS framework, then I'm going to jump to the performance framework, and then I'm going back to the ASBUS framework. And you will see later why. At the same time, I'm going to tell you like how you can use some of these bottoms that we have in the top of the website. So there are basically, let me go back to the portal 1 second, because I wanted to show you that in what we call the tutorial, you have all this information that I'm just telling you here in a kind of interactive way. You can go there and you can read about the BBBs, you can read about the ASBUS. So the ASBUS framework has the same key concept that it had before. So we have an ASBUS thread, we have the blocks, we have the modules, we have the elements, which is a new kind of concept of this sixth edition of the GAP. And we have the enablers, which is another key new concept of this sixth edition of the GAP. Now, why did we include this element and enabler concepts? We included these concepts because people said that the description at the module level of the ASBUS, it was not detailed enough, and not all the ASBUS had the same level of granularity on how they were explained. So what we did is we include this new concept that we call element, that is basically each specific operational improvement that we had before defined in the modules. Okay, and then we have the enablers, which are basically the components. And when I say components, I mean, which is the avionics, which is the ground systems, which is the procedures, which is the regulations, which is the training that I need to have in place in order to be able to implement the whole operational improvement that is described in the ASBUS element. If I don't have the regulations, if I don't have the avionic, I could have all the rest of the things, but I will not be able to implement the operational improvement described in the ASBUS element. So you have the definitions of each of these key concepts in the tutorial, and I will not read them because you will have time to do that, you know. But they are basically the same concepts as we had before. The only difference is these two new concepts of elements and enablers. So going back to our ASBUS view, so as I was saying,
could we take a 10-minute break whenever you have, and whenever you consider appropriate?
Do you want to do it now? We can do it now.
Perfect.
Okay, so let's come back, please, at 10:45. That's okay.
Perfect.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, okay, gracias, Olga. Muchas gracias. Entonces retornamos a las 10:45. Perdón. Sería, sí, hora Lima 10:45.
Okay, gracias.
Está bien.
La cresta sobre la parte que está aquí del área, y esta mapa de nuestra funcionada y que hacemos un pequeño pliegue en esta situación arquitectónica que está predominando y que está a través de su territorio. En 300 lugares tenemos esta reparación de transición ciclónica, con este miedo que tenemos en esta partida, nos da, ¿no?, lo que es la circulación sobre el Caribe y otra, y la cresta, ¿no?, la parte de esta cuña.
And just choose to not have the description of the different operations in the different blocks, or you could choose to have the concept of operations but not the list of elements. Why these two tabs are important? Well, honestly, when you are just working online like we are doing now, they are not very important, but they are very important when you actually try to print the information. So there are two ways to print the information here, okay? And they're similar in the other view that we will have of the ASPU framework. One is through this sheet that you see here, okay? So this sheet, it will actually print you the information on that specific area. So for instance, in this case, it has printed me the list of elements and the concept operations. Now, if I only selected, for instance, the ASPU elements and I click print, I will only get print the list of elements that I had in this area. Now, what happens if what I want to do is not to print only the information in the meteorological information area, but I want to print the information in all the areas? Then I go up here where it's written generate PDF and I click here. Now, when I click here, as you could see, it takes more time because it is more information than one that it has to grab, the portal has to grab from the database. But as you will see, it actually prints me a report where I will have the list of elements because it's the one that I had selected, okay, in all the areas that we have within the ASPU framework. Now, as you can see, it only printed me the elements because it's the only one that I had selected. If I would have selected both of them, it would have printed me everything. Now it would also take more time and more pages if I really want to print them in paper. So that's why this is useful. Another thing that you have here, and it is actually very important, is something that we call change request. So when you go to the strategic level of the camp, which is actually this overall umbrella, and I forgot to say, but this concept of operation of each thread is basically derived from the conceptual roadmap that we have in this in the strategic level. Okay, so when you go to the global strategic level, you would see in the introduction where it says how the GAMP is maintained, that when it gets to the maintenance of the ASPU framework, there is a change request that actually it was implemented with this edition of the GAMP, where it is the first time that the ASPU framework, it will not be developed only with the input from ICAO and the secretariat and the experts that come to the panels of ICAO to develop the ASPU framework from NextGen, CSR, et cetera, but also from you, from the implementers. We want to actually have feedback. So the way in which you can provide feedback to the ASPU framework or change a request that is actually justified is by clicking here and you will download a template. I have actually encouraged this to be done at the regional level and coordinated through the regional office in order to not duplicate efforts. So if you open the Word file that it is actually downloaded, I don't know what I did. you will see that you have instructions. Okay. You will see that you have instructions in which are the steps that you have to follow in order to submit a change to the ASPO framework. So once we have received enough changes, we will run what we call a campaign and we will update the ASPO framework. And then we will publish which are the changes that were accepted and which are the changes that were rejected. So in this way, we have implemented a system in which people will be able to keep track of the changes that happened to the ASPO framework, what we did not have before. So this is something that is also available to you now. So no more things here.
Un comentario, Francisco, un comentario. Es bastante interesante entender que tenemos atividades que são finais, não, que estão como atividades finais para os usuários, para a aviação, e esta parte de CNS é infraestrutura, é meio. Eu sempre não costumo dizer que comunicações, que infraestrutura é meio, não, para proveer esses serviços. Pero é um meio muito importante. Pero não é a parte final, não. Não é algo que proporciona, não. A infraestrutura proporciona os meios para que as atividades finais possam prover seus serviços. Então, há que tomar em conta que, e isso vamos a ver em la metodologia, que há que saber especificamente medir bem para saber o que tem que implantar de infraestrutura para prover os serviços, para prover os meios para que esses serviços sejam prestados. Isso é bem claro em essa estrutura dada não com hilos condutores. Graças.
Gracias, Francisco. Exactamente, como estaba diciendo, as I was saying, the CNS technology and services, as well as the information threads, contain elements which would be actually enablers of the ASPO elements that we have in the operational threads. We will see that better when we go to the other view that I will call just now. If you allow me, then we move forward and then we move to the next view, which is actually we go back to the tab and we now click in the ASPO elements. Now, in order to try to be consistent on the level of description of each ASPO element, we basically develop a template that contains different parts in order to define each ASPO element that we had in the ASPO framework. Now, this template basically consisted of the same thing. First, the ASPO element had an ASPO ID, which consisted of the thread in which the element was, then the block the element belonged to, like when did the aviation community agreed to work or to deliver that operational improvement, and then just an aleatorio number for that element in that block, in that area or thread. So for instance, ACAS B01, okay, is the ID, which has basically the name of ACAS improvement, which it belongs to an operational thread, as we can see here. And we will see what's the difference between operational and enabler threads, like Francisco was highlighting just now, in a few moments. Then you will have the main purpose. Now, what is the main purpose? The main purpose is the why. Why do we need these operational improvement, okay? For what are we going to use this operational improvement? That's what the main purpose tells us about. Then we have a description of the new capabilities, basically the what. What is this ASPO element? What does it consist of? Then we have basically more information on how this what works. So basically it tells you like how this what is actually going to improve the why. Okay, so basically new purpose, new capabilities and description are linked. You will see as you read the elements. Then we have the maturity level of the element. Now we have different maturity levels depending on the phase in which each ASBU element it is in within the development by the aviation industry. So we have elements that are in a concept kind of a stage. So those are elements that we can find more in block four, okay? Which is, I said 20, block three, block one. Well, I cannot, let me do the numbers. Block one, we said 2019, block two, 2025, block three, 2031. So 2037, basically we will find lots of ASBU elements that are in this concept kind of stage. Even in block three, we will find some of them. Then we have elements that are in a validation stage. So they have already come through the concept and they are being validated by the industry. We have elements that are in a standardization stage. So the validation is already gone by the industry and it has come back for ICAO in order to develop this standardization. And then once ICAO has delivered then, and all these phases have been completed, then we are at an implementation kind of a stage. So these are the different maturity levels that you will find. You will find also human factors considerations. So it just consists of four different questions, but they are very important questions that the implementers should consider if they decide to implement this ASBU element. Okay, so does this ASBU element imply a change in the task by a user or affected others? That's yes or no. Does it imply processing of new information by the user? Yes, and sometimes you have how. Does it imply the use of new equipment? Yes. Does it imply a change to levels of automation? So depending on this, you will have to consider having one or another training for the implementation of this operational improvement. We are developing, and I have seen the hand, and I will give you the floor just now. But before I give you the floor, I have to say that we are in the latest phase of reviewing a manual for human factors considerations. And once the manual it is available, we will make it available here in a hyperlink for you to download it to basically address these human factors considerations in implementation of these operational improvements. Yes, go ahead, please. Telcea, Brazil.
Yes, Davi from Brazil. Let me see if I understood, Olga. So for a specific element, I have some enablers, right? So for me as a navigation service provider in Brazil, to implement this specific element, I need to have all the enablers read. But yes. My question is, some enablers is not up to me. It's going to be with industry, with their, you know, is subject to some technology, right?
Yes. So your question is very valid, David. And actually that is what I said at the beginning when we were talking about the roles and responsibilities in the strategic level, you remember? I said, the most important thing for a national air navigation plan to succeed is to have everybody that will be responsible for the implementation of each of these operational improvements represented in the committee. Okay, and this will give us a clue of who has to be represented in the committee. Okay, so if we go down here, and I'm going to come back here, but just because of the question, and I click here enablers, okay, I will see here all the enablers that I need in order to implement ACAS B11, this ASBU element. Now, as part of these enablers, I will have here, as you say, like regulatory provisions, which are actually in the hands of the authority and the aircraft manufacturer. I will have operational procedures that are in charge of the ANSP and the aircraft operator. I will have aircraft system, which are in charge, like the responsible for implementing them are aircraft manufacturer. So all these stakeholders here are the stakeholders that I need to have represented in my committee who is in charge of developing the National Air Navigation Plan. because if not, will happen what you were just saying to, like, I want to implement this, but I can only do the first one. Then what am I going to do? Yes? David, is it okay?
Sorry, that's right, Olga. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. So this is very important, actually, okay? Pregunta. And this,
Pregunta.
Yes. Go ahead, please.
Sí, gracias. El manual que se hizo referencia es sobre los factores humanos.
Sí.
Que estaban en desarrollo.
I'm not sure who is talking. Can you please introduce yourself?
I'm sorry. My name is Rosana from Uruguay.
Okay, Rosana. Soy inspectora de navegación aérea. Muy bien, muchas gracias. Encantada de conocerla, Rosana. Entonces, como íbamos diciendo, sí, el manual de factores humanos, hace 2 semanas yo le estuve revisando como final review. Entonces, yo creo que antes de, pues si no es este mes, a principios del año, cuando acaben en editorial de formatearlo, lo publicarán. Y como digo, va a ser un manual que una vez que esté disponible, lo pondremos aquí junto con estas preguntas, porque las mismas personas que han desarrollado el manual fueron las personas que nos dieron estas preguntas para incluir aquí, que tuvieron que ser respondidas siguiendo unas pautas por la gente que estaba desarrollando el framework de los ASBUS. Entonces, una vez que tengamos ese manual, hemos acordado que lo vamos a poner aquí disponible para que la gente lo pueda usar. ¿Vale? Es un manual muy bueno, de hecho. Yo, por ejemplo, yo nunca he leído sobre Human Factors y la verdad es que fue una lectura, lo tuve que leer para revisarlo, y fue una lectura muy interesante, así que recomiendo que todo el mundo se lo lea, aunque realmente no estés involucrado en eso, porque creo que te hace creer desde el punto de vista profesional, dando otra perspectiva a las cosas, ¿no?
No, muchas gracias.
¿Vale, Osana?
Gracias.
Nada, un placer. Ok, and then we have the planning. Yes?
One more question. This is from Barbados. On the enablers, sorry? This sorry? Is... The new from Barbados.
Barbados, nice to meet you. Thomas, please.
In the table where you have the dependencies and the enablers for implementing the ASBU element, you have year. Yes. Is this the year? Is this a timeline for which you're supposed to implement with the actual enabler, like the regulatory person or
Yeah, so what is this year here? No, it's very confusing because actually each of them has different years. So that's a very good question. Thank you very much for it. The year here, it is actually the year where the people that are responsible for developing this enabler, they have actually finished development. So for instance, the aircraft manufacturers, they make available the avionics people, so Honeywell and all of these people, they actually commit, okay, within the ASBU framework to make available these avionics that the aircraft manufacturers should implement by 2008. ICAO committed to develop SARS for TCAS version 7.1 in 2014, and they were basically finished in 2014. So all these years, they are basically years in which all these enablers, they became available, okay? Now what happened here, for instance, is that because each of the enablers became available in 1 year, really, we could not have implemented this element till 2014, because in 2010, we did not have the regulatory provisions necessary to implement this element, and we did not have the operational approval to implement this element. So this is the year when the element enablers, they became available, not when they have to implement to be implemented, okay? When they became available. Now, okay. What this year tells us is which is the block in which we'll be able to find this element. So for instance, the latest of this year is 2014, which means that this element by 2013, which is the year of the block zero, this element was not available because it had two enablers that were not available yet. So that's why we find this element in block one, because block one goes all the years from 2013 till 2019. And by 2019, we already had all these enablers available.
Okay, thank you.
Yes?
Yes.
You're welcome. Then another information that we have here is the planning layer. So basically it tells us which are the planning layers that this element impacts, okay? So you have there all the planning layers. In this case, the one that this element impacts is tactical or during operations. And it tells you which are the phases, okay, that this element would impact. So this is the phases of the flight. In this case, it's departure, en route, and arrival. Something very important that we will see also in another view is the dependencies and relations. So in this case, this operational element that is ACAS, it is dependent, it has a technology need on an element that is actually technology. And somebody will tell me, but Olga, you just told us that all the enablers are listed under here. So why do you have this here? Very good question too. So when you have this element here, ADSB surveillance, you have to find an enabler that is aligned with that need. So when an enabler, it is an element in another thread, you will actually find it in the dependency box. Okay?
Okay, thank you.
Good. Thanks a lot. So we will see that. So now you will tell us, okay, Olga, but you have told us that, you know, it is different if we have an operational thread than if we have an information or a technology thread. In which way it is different, no? So let's use the buttons that we have here, these red buttons that we have at the top of the site. So let's click edit filters. Why are filters important? For the same reason that I was telling you before, because if I select everything and I don't get the filter and I click generate PDF, I will get a warning saying, Olga, you are about to print 500 pages. Do you really want to do that? Obviously, I don't want to do that because it would take us 20 minutes to generate this PDF, okay? So that's why the filters are important. Now, we are going to take APTA, for instance, that is an operational thread, okay? And then I'm going to take another thread that is not operational, like, let's take the MET thread because Jorge is our MET guy. Where is it? MET, here. And we had just seen it. So I'm going to apply filters, okay? You have here filters by all the things that we have been talking about just now, but I'm just going to use the ones of the areas. And I click apply filters. Okay, and then it will filter me the threads or areas of meteorological information and AMIT, okay, information and APTA, operations. So APTA has operational improvements that are in the terminal in the approach, okay? So that's what APTA refers to. APTA is the area of the terminal area and the approach. And we will find then operational improvements within that area. In the AMET, we will find operational improvements on how to improve the delivery of MET information in the navigation system. Now, why they are different, these two areas? Let me filter again, and I'm going to just take the ones of block zero, okay? So we can reduce the number of elements and maybe we can see them in the same screen. Perfect. So you see there are different colors. Actually, before we didn't have here information of all operational, we just had different colors and then somebody complained that daltonic people would not be able to differentiate between the two, which was a very valid complaint, to be honest, that we did not think about. So that's why we added this here. So if you have any other kind of suggestion on how to improve the portal, just please go ahead and just tell me because I will actually be very grateful for that feedback. So we saw the functional description and we saw the enablers. Now, what about the deployment applicability and the performance impact assessment? If we click the deployment applicability and the performance impact assessment, okay, we will see that in the Met, we have nothing. In the APTA, we have things. Why? The reason is that, as Francisco was saying, the information threads, they are enablers, okay? So the ASBU elements and the threads that are actually enablers, that they belong to the categories of information or CNS technology and services, they are not, they do not have a deployment applicability and they do not have a performance impact assessment. And why is that? That is because they can be applied to different operational improvements and they can contribute in a percentage to the benefit of that operational improvement. However, you cannot quantify how much if you can get from having, for instance, a technology deployed, because it's just not something that is a percentage. It's you need to have it in order to have something else. So that's why you will not have deployment applicability or performance impact assessment in the information and technology elements. Now, we have seen that, so we don't care about the Met anymore. We are going to, for the moment, being unselected. Wait, I could have done it here, sorry, stupid. So you can also remove the filters by clicking these ones here, okay? But we are going to stay with the APTA one. So what do I have in deployment applicability? In deployment applicability, I have basically the operational conditions under which this element will actually bring me benefits. There are not all the elements implemented in everywhere will actually give you benefits. So it is very important that you actually look at the operational conditions. Then it will tell you which are the main direct benefits, which are the indirect benefits, and which are the people that will actually benefit from those benefits. Why is this important? Because as we were saying with enablers, that this is important to have all these people in this committee in charge of developing the National Air Navigation Plan. These people, sometimes the people that have to put the money for an implementation are not actually the people that get the benefit from it, okay? So whenever we are deciding what are we going to implement, maybe when we get to the cost benefit analysis, we need to analyze who will have to put the money, who will benefit, and then reassess who has to put the money. So this is the kind of information that the tools, the information that the GAN portal provides you with in order to do your own planning, in order to agree your own arrangements within your state. And then it tells you the intended performance impacts in specific KPIs. In order to explain this, I am going to jump into the performance framework that I talked to you about just before. Sorry. So we move to the performance framework, okay? Now, the performance framework, it is basically composed of two things, okay? We have a performance objective catalog, and I'm going to start through that, okay? So we click in the performance objective catalog. So what is this catalog? This catalog is, we took the performance ambitions, okay, that I show you in the strategic level, the 11 key performance areas, and we say, okay, in order to improve capacity, I can improve capacity at the aerodrome. I can improve capacity at the TMA. I could improve capacity in the FIR. I could improve capacity in several different places. Now, once in the airport, I could increase like the utilization of the capacity. Maybe I have a capacity enough, but there is bad weather and I'm not using it. Or actually, I am using all the capacity and I need to build another runway. So there are different types of capacity that can be improved with inside the capacity key performance area. So we did all this development of the capacity key performance area into what we call focus areas. So we have capacity and we have two focus areas, capacity throughput and utilization, or shortfall and associated delay, Then inside of these focus areas, we have more sub-focus areas, and like that. And then once we have defined the sub-focus areas, okay, we start defining objectives. So the objectives are just associated to a specific area within a sub-focus area. So for instance, in the airport terminal airspace throughput and capacity, I could increase the capacity by increasing the airport throughput in departures and arrivals, or by improving the multi-airport terminal airspace throughput.
Tesoría, ¿qué tienen? Faustino ahí en su changarro. Ya le puse el cable de red, pero me pide una clave, ¿tú sabes? ¿Tesoría?
No.
O estoy haciendo mala conexión, a ver.
Okay, so let's continue. So these objectives, you know, and the difference between our focus areas and objective is that usually the objective has a verb in it, un verbo. So for instance, in this case, increase, or in this case, improve. While a focus area is just a substantive, a noun, it doesn't have a verb, okay? So you will have here like objectives and sub-objectives that are one inside the other ones, okay? So we did this exercise in a very methodological approach. And some of you have been lately involved in the development of these three in the safety key performance area and have seen how difficult it is actually to develop these trees, that it looks that it's a simple task. It is not that simple. So we have developed these trees for the areas of efficiency, capacity, and predictability. And within the last month, we have done the same thing for the safety key performance area. And that's what I was going to show you, that it will go into the paper that will be presented to this omnibus kind of conference, where we will actually present a tree that will be proposed for the safety key performance area and will then be included in this tree within the GAM framework. So you can see here the reasoning why. And at the end of this huge document that it was developed with a huge effort by the YPEC, the group of experts helping us to develop the tree, you will see which is the proposal to update the tree with and the indicators, okay? So this is basically something that will come, but for the moment being, you only have this tree developed for capacity, efficiency, and predictability. The next one will be safety, and then we will continue, okay? But within capacity, then you have sometimes associated to these objectives, you have some KPIs. Now these KPIs, they are indicators, key performance indicators, which actually help us to measure the progress that has been done within terms of those objectives. So in this case, we have key performance indicator number 10. The indicators, they also follow a template to be developed. So they consist of a definition, measurement units, operations measure, variance, et cetera, et cetera. How to measure it, and this is very important actually. And then at the end you have examples on where those indicators have been measured. So these indicators, in this case, we have key performance indicator 10, but there are 19 indicators, plus three more that are proposed for safety within next year. Sorry, are linked to some of the objectives in the performance objective catalog. Now, what happens when I actually link one KPI to one objective? What happens is that all the subjectives, okay, these two plus all the ones that are inside it, if I change one of the subjectives of the objective that I'm looking at that is linked to a KPI, then it will change my KPI. So although this KPI is just linked to this objective, actually it is also linked to all these sub-objectives that are inside this objective. This is very important to keep in mind because as I told you at the beginning, I'm going to show you how we build the tool. And then I'm going to show you how we use the tool, which is actually the other way around, okay? So then how we did is basically we went to the, close it. Yeah. When we were in the ASBU element of APTA,
when we were in the ASBU element of APTA, and I was telling you that we were talking about the performance impact assessment, how did we do that performance impact assessment? So let me keep, okay. So what we did in this case is in the last part of the template, that is performance impact assessment, this one over here, we basically link each of the ASBU elements to a performance objective. And we put one cross or two crosses depending on the impact that it has. But we basically link to each of these objectives from the objective catalog. And when we did that, the system automatically grabbed us the key, if there was any key performance indicator that was associated to that objective, okay? Again, this is very important to then use the tool the other way around. This is how we built it, okay? Any questions on this?
Olga, hay una pregunta de Argentina. Susana, ¿cómo se relacionan matemáticamente los objetivos de los KPIs?
¿Cómo se relacionan matemáticamente? Perdona, Francisco, no te he oído.
Si Susana puede hablar, por favor, y hacer la pregunta.
Sí, ¿qué tal? Buenos días, hola, buenas tardes. El tema es, como estamos hablando de objetivos, subobjetivos, ¿cómo voy subiendo de niveles para medir el impacto de los subobjetivos, o sea, la relación entre los subobjetivos para que impacten el objetivo, para, o sea, cómo es la cadena matemática, algorítmica, que tenemos que armar la fórmula para decir, bueno, este sumando, sabemos que sumando los objetivos para llegar a, qué sé yo, a determinar qué nivel estamos de cumplimiento, de rendimiento del objetivo general, ¿no? Porque lo hacemos a por suma, si lo... por proporción, no sé si a, me explico.
A ver si lo he entendido.
Sí.
Estos subobjetivos, por ejemplo, el objetivo de increase airport throughput, ¿vale? Tiene dos subobjetivos inmediatos, digámoslo así. Una que es increase airport arrival rate y otro que es increase airport departure rate, ¿ok? ¿Vale? Que los influyen directamente. Y cuando yo cambie uno de estos dos subobjetivos directos que tengo, voy a cambiar el valor del KPI 10. Ahora, que incremente uno de ellos en el 50% no quiere decir que el final se vaya a incrementar en un 50%. Eso va a depender de las circunstancias a las que esté mi aeropuerto. Lo que nosotros estamos dando a lo que nosotros les estamos proveyendo a los estados es con el link a nivel de KPI a objetivo basado en el scope del ASBU, ¿vale? Entonces, por ejemplo, en el caso de APTA, ¿vale? En el caso de APTA, ¿vale? Estos objetivos son que están mucho más abajo. O sea, nosotros hemos intentado ligarlo cuanto más abajo lo posible mejor para no confundirnos, ¿vale? Entonces, este subobjetivo, como lo que estás viendo usted aquí, no va... No es ninguno de estos que están, no es este que está aquí,
no,
sino perfecto. Que va a estar mucho más dentro, más abajo, porque nosotros le hemos ligado al máximo, al mínimo nivel del scope, a cuál es el incremento directo, ¿vale? Entonces, nosotros hemos ido a las ASBU element, hemos leído la descripción y hemos visto, lo que va a hacer esto es que al poner en el final de la pista un sistema adicional, ¿vale? Me va a incrementar la capacidad de la pista. Entonces, cuando tú vayas al árbol, vas a ver en el árbol que nosotros hemos... a lo mejor debería... Ah, bueno, vale, es que no. A ver, déjame, te voy a decir cómo lo hago yo, ¿vale? Para que lo veas.
Claro, el tema es cómo impactan cuando hay un objetivo como en este caso, ¿no? A ver, voy a la pantalla mía. Sí.
Como yo lo hago, por ejemplo, es, yo quiero saber dónde está este objetivo, ¿vale? Entonces, yo le copio, ¿vale? Y una vez que he hecho el PDF, le doy a control buscar y le pego, ¿vale? En este caso, pues no está funcionando, pero no sé por qué.
Pero, o sea que los trato como objetivos independientes, por más que tengan subobjetivos dentro, porque hay KPI que tiene subobjetivos dentro. O sea, el nivel de ese subobjetivo no va a impactar en el objetivo. O sea, los tomo independientes. Los tomo independientes, por más que tenga una vinculación con subobjetivos. Porque, claro, nosotros tratamos de hacer en un Excel básico cómo impactaba para arriba, o sea, el rendimiento de un tratamos de armar una planilla Excel identificando subobjetivos, objetivos, o sea, en cadena. Y cuando quisimos ver el impacto de lo que estaba más abajo de la cadena sobre el objetivo general, ¡epa! ¿Qué algoritmo aplicamos? Ahora me aclarás porque, claro, lo aplicamos directamente. Hacemos, no importa en qué nivel de la cadena esté.
No importa.
Yo lo que está en amarillo lo tomo como nivel primario, digamos. Claro. Así esté incluido dentro de un nivel. Sí.
Es como una función escalón, ¿vale? Es un sí o un no. No es un no tiene ninguna pendiente ni ninguna continuidad, ¿vale? Entonces, lo que te permite el árbol es ver si va a impactar un indicador o no, pero no te va a decir en qué forma le va a impactar. Porque esa forma que ustedes querían calcularlo es imposible de calcular, porque depende de tantísimos factores que no se puede calcular. Lo único que se puede calcular es si realmente va a tener un efecto o no, pero no cómo va a afectar. Hay a lo mejor el mismo subobjetivo del mismo ASBU, te vas a implementar en Argentina y en México, y en una te va a incrementar un 10 y en el otro un 20.
Bueno, lo importante que me tiene que quedar en la cabeza es, nos tiene que quedar en la cabeza el grupo que el objetivo de medición lo tomamos lo tomamos como un primario independientemente el lugar de la cadena en que esté.
Sí, pero lo que sí que es importante, y eso es lo que yo estaba intentando, que a lo mejor, por ejemplo, aquí, ¿vale? En este ejemplo, en el ejemplo de Reduce Taxi Outcome, ¿vale? Vamos a ver, déjame que abra el KPI 2, ¿vale? Aquí, en el Reduce Taxi Time, ¿vale? Tenemos que puedes reducir el Taxi Time Out, ¿vale? De dos formas. Una, reduciendo básicamente el tiempo extra que estás gastando que no es necesario, o reduciendo el mínimo tiempo que de verdad te tarda en llegar. Por ejemplo, si yo tengo colapso de aviones, pues evidentemente no es un tema de infraestructura, es un tema de que podría de verdad mejorar el exactamente. Mientras que si es realmente que para salirme de la pista me tengo que dar la vuelta al final y volver a salirme, o lo que sea, entonces es una cosa de infraestructura. Realmente no hay otra forma de salir. Entonces, estas son las dos cosas. Ahora, si tú ves el KPI 02, ¿vale? Que te dice taxi out additional time. No te dice taxi out time. Te dice taxi out additional time, ¿ok? Entonces te dice, realmente lo que te mide es el taxi out time que tú gastas actualmente comparado con el que deberías de gastar de acuerdo con tu infraestructura. Si vas aquí, vas a ver que el KPI 02 está ligado con el tiempo adicional, no con el tiempo mínimo.
No, con el tiempo adicional, sí. A ver, abrí ese. Ahí está. Entonces, estas van a ser todas las variables que yo voy a tener en cuenta para formar este KPI. Claro. Y la ponderación que yo le dé a estas variables, porque suponete que tome dos variables. Voy a tomar, ¿cuál es la ponderación que voy a tomarle para construir la reducción del indicador? ¿Cuánto impactó.
Pero no es un tema tanto, sí, Susana, perdona que te interrumpa, no es un tema tanto de ponderación como de aplicabilidad. Por ejemplo,
está bien.
Esto es condiciones adversas. Tú a lo mejor tienes sol todo el día, con lo cual sí. Eso es cero, ¿vale? Sí. Por eso estábamos diciendo al principio que tienes que realmente entender cuáles son los challenges de tu aeropuerto, en está este bien. Caso. Porque si tu aeropuerto tiene un solazo no. todo el día, pues esto no te vale para nada. Entonces no. tú le tendrías que tachar, ¿vale?
Está.
Siguiente, las barras de stop. ¿Tengo barras de stop o no tengo? Porque claro, si no tengo, a lo mejor estos dos tampoco, tampoco me aplican.
Lo desestimo, sí.
Exactamente. Okay. Entonces, no, no. el árbol te tiene que ayudar más a eso que en cuanto a ver cuánto más
es orientativo,
de cada
entendido. Exactamente. Claro, bueno, pero es el problema nuestro era, acá porque estoy en un nivel más bajo, pero hay KPI que están en un objetivo más arriba y con una cadena. Entonces decíamos, bueno, ¿y cómo impacta? Ahora nos dejaste claro. Los tomamos como independiente, independientemente del formato conceptual que armaron ustedes de los KPI. O sea, yo tomo los amarillos porque ya son los que están desarrollados.
Exactamente.
No importa por qué criterios están estos desarrollados y los otros no, pero bueno.
Están desarrollados porque son más fáciles de medir.
Claro, entonces directamente lo tomamos como objetivos independientes. Ya está, ya se nos... fue el problema de armar el árbol. Muchas gracias.
Claro, ¿eh? sobre todo es para la aplicabilidad, porque muchas sí. veces, ¿sabes lo que pasa? Por ejemplo, en creo que fue en Cairo, en el aeropuerto de Cairo, compraron un sistema para la gestión del tráfico, ¿vale? En ground, en tierra, y yo creo que es que no lo han usado jamás, porque allí no tiene ningún problema de visibilidad, tiene un tiempo estupendo, con lo cual compraron eso porque vieron que lo ponía en un ASBU, pero vamos a ver, es que en un ASBU te ponen muchas cosas, porque hay otras personas que también tienen un problema de tiempo, pero si tú no lo tienes, pues eso tú lo tienes que tachar. Esto es claro. una cosa genérica, que luego cada uno le tiene que claro. Tailor, le tienes que, ¿cómo se dice? Tailor, a moldar. A tus necesidades, a tu
perfecto.
Environment. ¿Vale?
Ay, sí. Ok, bueno, okay. Muchas gracias, ¿eh? Hasta luego.
De nada, un placer. Ok, so this is very important, as I was saying, okay? Because all these objectives, they actually contribute to KPI 002, and we will see why this is important. Now, we have come here to the top, and we see that we have the performance objectives, so we have the key performance indicators. We have seen now how the ASBUS relates actually to the performance framework, okay? And to the key performance indicators, how the database is actually built, okay? That is behind the portal. Now, what we are going to do now is we are going to go through a few more tools that we have here, and then we are going to go through how to use this. So there is a way where on how to do this is actually not go through all ASBU elements and say, okay, are there, because we have maybe 500 ASBU elements, so you don't have to do that. You don't have to code each ASBU and say, okay, I'm going to read the description, the applicability, check if it's applicable, if it's not applicable. That's not the way it works. That's not a performance-based approach. That's what we were talking about, that we need to be efficient in the allocation of resources. So what we need to do is basically measure how we are performing. That's through the key performance indicators and the list of key performance indicators, this one that we were talking about, we need to measure the key performance indicators. Now, once we have the key performance indicators, we need to understand which are the potential solutions. They are not solutions that we need to implement. They are potential solutions that we could implement in order to implement a key performance indicator. So for instance, if we want to improve, we measure key performance indicator 10. And our airport peak throughput is just 40%, and we need to improve it, okay? So all these operational improvements could help us to improve our KPIs 10. It could help us if the thing that the ASBU element is going to solve, it is actually linked to the problem that we have. As I was saying, if you don't have a weather issue, you cannot implement an ASBU that is just directed to fix a weather issue because you will not have any kind of improvement. So all of these are list of ASBUs, but it has already filtered you. Instead of 500, you now have like 60 that you have to actually go through in order to understand which one could help you, okay? Plus, if you say, okay, so some of them are here are directed to the airport, some of them are directed to, more to the terminal, et cetera, then some to the approach, then you can actually reduce this kind of potential ASBUs that could help you. But at the end, you need to understand manually, basically, how based on your operational scenario, which is the one that could actually help you. So this is a manual way of doing it, okay? We will see later an automatic way of doing it. This is the manual way of doing it. This is the way we use the ASBU framework, not going to the ASBU framework and ASBU element by ASBU element. No, we go to the key performance indicators and the key performance areas, and we select the ASBUs that could help us improve that area. Now, more tools that we have available here. We have the TBO3, and I'm going to go very briefly through this because it's a more kind of theoretical thing. So the TBO threat, which is an area that we call trajectory-based operations in the fifth edition of the GAMP, the TBO was a concept. Now it's a more developed concept. Before, we didn't know what was it about, and we put all the communication, digital communications inside the TBO threat. Now we have a better understanding because we published the TBO concept. So basically, the trajectory-based operation thread, what it does is it synchronizes all the ASBU elements in the other operational threads. So as you will see here, all the elements of the TBO thread, all the enablers of the elements in the TBO thread, they are actually the elements in the operational threads. So TBO is a concept that what basically it does is integrates the operations of different flights from the departure to the arrival. You can click in each of these and you will see how, which is basically how the TBO concept will evolve. If you click TBO B01, TBO B11, B21, et cetera, and then you can click each of the ASBUs that are linked to each of these TBO concepts. You can also come to the ASBU framework and click in technology roadmaps. So here you will see basically, in this case, we have selected the COMIC, it's COM infrastructure thread. And in the COM infrastructure thread, we have within blocks zero, we have 7 elements. In block 1, we have 4. Block 2, we have 3. Block 3, we have 4. And you have the ASBU elements that actually depend on the enablers that you have before. So usually the commit thread, it feeds basically information and com services thread. But if you select com services, you will actually find more operational elements. So we still need to improve these technology roadmaps, but we haven't finished improving them yet. And then the other tool that you have is how to look at the dependency graph. So this graph basically shows us all the types of dependencies that we have in the system. And the one I'm going to apply because it's kind of crazy, it's the evolution now. People say, okay, Olga, but why does it have a red and a green arrow? So in this case, for instance, I have selected the element that is COMI B04. Which is VHF data link mode 2 basic. So this element, when it has a green arrow, it means that the element is contributing to. And it when it has a red, it means that it takes from. So it's an evolution from, because it's red, B03, to, because it's green, B1 and B3. So you see, when you see green, you have to imagine an arrow coming out of the element that I have selected. And when you see red, you have to see an arrow coming in the element that I have selected. So people have suggested that we actually delete from here the elements that do not apply to the filter, and we will do that. And we add here a legend. So we also will do that with the different colors, red and green, what they mean. Now, this is important because it actually helps you to basically identify which are the enablers that can help us to implement different operational elements. So for instance, here you will see that the navigation ABAS system is actually contributing to APTA V01 because it's green, so it's going out. And when we go to APTA V01, we say PBN approaches, which we basically need of ABAS. So this is what Francisco was talking about. And the last tool that we have developed and we still need to improve, that's why we say that the states need to use the tool and tell us how bad the tool is because it has not been validated, is what we call ANSPA. So I have told you basically like how we built the portal and how you can actually use the indicators to select ASBUS manually. But what we did is we tried to automatize all this process so that states could go into this tool and just run in each specific operational environment this method of selecting ASBUS elements. So this is basically based on the six-step method that you have already attended many workshops on, and that is basically how to plan for the modernization of the air navigation system using performance. So you start a new report, basically. Let me see if it works. Yeah, a little bit slowly because also my connection is not great. But basically you will find here the six steps. So it starts with step one, which is always define the scope, context, and ambition. So imagine in this case, we are going to analyze a TMA, okay? The first question it asks you is like, okay, which is the planning horizon? Like, till when are we going to plan? So let's see, we plan medium term. Which is the key region do you belong to? This is important because of terms of interoperability and harmonization that we were talking about before. So we are in the CARSAM region. Well, the CARSAM region already have the CARSAM plan as we were talking about that is available here. Sorry. And it has some traffic forecast that ICAO calculates for it that is also available here. So we can see actually how the demand will actually evolve in order to understand which our needs and our operational environment. We continue and we say, okay, in terms of performance ambitions, my politicians have promised people that they will reduce the delay, increase safety, and maintain predictability while reducing the environment, okay? For instance, you need to prioritize because if not, you will never move forward, even if at the end you change your priorities. Now, as part of step two, it is very important that you actually know your system and identify your objectives, okay? So in order to do that, we suggest that you do a SWOT analysis and you identify which are your external opportunities and threats, positive and negative, and which are your internal strengths and weaknesses. As I say, if you have bad weather, that is an external threat because you cannot control your climate, you know? So you have to understand which is your SWOT analysis that will actually serve you to disregard or remove objectives from the tree. So you start the question. So in here, instead of doing a SWOT analysis, because obviously we could not have the computer talking to you on the telephone, we prepare a list of questions. And these questions, what they basically do is they remove from the tree objectives that are not applicable to your case. Thus, the demand seeks the capacity by asking you a series of questions. So you reply to these questions. You know, we need to improve this. Also, people have said that they would like to have a bar because sometimes there is so many questions that people say, oh my God, like when is it going to finish? So I understand that sometimes can be actually challenging to answer all these questions, but the tree is very big. So we tried to ask as many questions as we could. Now the questions finish, okay? So you have now filtered in the tree that I was telling you by removing objectives based on the reply of these questions. And then based on that questions and the answers that you provide, the tool, the system basically gives you the one that could be applicable to your case, which are the green ones. Now that doesn't mean that I have to include all the ones that the tool gave me, you know, like as Susana was saying, I could use the top one, sorry, or maybe one that is at a lower level. That really doesn't matter, okay? As soon as you choose one that is applicable to your case, very important. Now, once you have chosen the objectives, you continue to the next step. And then you have to quantify the objectives. And how do you do that? You do that through the indicators. So in this case, based on the objectives that we have selected, these are the indicators that will actually help us to understand how the system has been improved. And this is the way how we actually could measure the indicators, okay? Once you have a baseline, as I say, we couldn't do that with the performance ambitions at a global level. But once you have a baseline and you have actually a number of your airport, it is good that you establish a target. So you say within the next 3 years, I want to improve by 5%, for instance. So that would be your target. Your target is specific, measurable, achievable, relevant, and time-bounded. So specific and measurable is provided to you through the key performance indicators. Achievable, relevant, and time-bounded depends on your system. Now, if we continue to the next step, now based on all of these, okay, and this also filters the other way around, okay, the way we have seen in the dashboard, okay, this is the dashboard elements that could actually help you to improve your system. Block one and block two. It doesn't have block three because we selected medium term, you remember? So depending on which you selected, you will have different options in the whole study here. Now, this doesn't mean that you have to implement all this list of ASBOs. This is a potential list of solutions. Now, from this potential list, maybe I select three, two, or one. How do I do that? So you need to do a safety assessment. You need to discard that the options are actually safe to implement. You need to do an environmental impact assessment. You need to do a human factors assessment that would be in the manual once it's available. And then you need to do a cost benefit analysis because without money at the end, there will be no implementation. So ICAO has given you some tools and guidance which are made available to you here on how to, from all these list of potential solutions, select the ones you want to implement in your plan. Once you have decided to implement certain ASBO elements, it is important that you actually keep track of the implementation of that operational improvement. And how do I do that? So you need to do like project management. Basically, you need to see that the project is according to a schedule, that is not delayed, which is the issues that why it was delayed, if it was delayed, and how to try to solve them, etc., etc. And then at the end, and it is actually very important, you have to assess your achievement. You have to actually measure again the indicator to understand that the solution that you selected it in a right way because your performance have improved. And then the circle starts again. This is what we were talking about of the six-step performance framework. And this is how the GAMP portal is built. So when you finish, your full report will be saved in your the full report, which is available here, will be saved in your profile. You return and then you will see it here and you can keep it and delete it. So this is what we are working on. We still have room for improvement, of course. We have to enable the deselect of objective, for instance, and some other feedback that people have provided us with. But we think that it is actually an important tool for people to understand how the ASBOs are built and what is more important, how the ASBOs should be used. So that is all from my side, unless there is a question, but I think I actually finished on time. So thank you a lot for your attention. And thank you for the questions. Back to you, Jorge.
Muchas gracias, Olga, por toda la explicación, por cuadrar las consultas. Daría una sesión de preguntas y respuestas a los participantes. Por favor, si pueden alzar la mano para hacer las preguntas o las consultas o los comentarios.
Primeramente hay una pregunta de Curazao.
Carlos, go ahead, please.
Carlos de Costa Rica, esto más que una pregunta es un comentario. Esta actividad me parece bastante útil. Hubo una muy similar de la oficina NAC de la OASI en Ciudad de México, que fue muy provechosa, al igual que esta. Regresando de la actividad, utilicé esta herramienta para escoger los elementos del ASBU que se van a implementar en Costa Rica y me pareció una herramienta muy útil, muy intuitiva y pues de mi parte animar al resto de los países a usarla. Eso es todo.
Muchas gracias, Carlos. ¿Listo?
Nivia Morales de Colombia.
Buen día, gracias. Olguita, una pregunta.
Veme.
Si nosotros podemos, como tenemos, digamos, varios escenarios, en principio nosotros estamos como jugando con la herramienta, nosotros podemos parar y volver sobre el mismo ejercicio, continuar las preguntas, continuar el ejercicio hasta terminarlo. Esa es una pregunta. Y la siguiente es, cuando llegamos al análisis costo-beneficio, nos pedía que estuviéramos suscritos y para la suscripción, para usar esa herramienta, nos pedía que tuviéramos otra, como una afiliación pagada. Y entonces, como no teníamos esa afiliación pagada, pues no pudimos continuar. La pregunta es si podemos usarla o no a propósito de, pues, de la NSP que tenemos acá. Y finalmente, darte las gracias. Muy, muy interesante el taller. Muchas gracias.
Gracias a ti, Nidia. Y gracias por las preguntas. Creo que no se puede de momento hacer lo que tú estás diciendo de volver al reporte o de empezar un reporte y dejarlo a medias. Pero déjame que les pregunte a la gente de informática si lo podemos poner para que la gente pueda hacer eso, porque me parece que es muy buena idea, ¿vale? Entonces me lo voy a apuntar para intentar ver si no se puede hacer, que creo que no se puede hacer ahora mismo, cómo lo podemos dar esa posibilidad al usuario. Con respecto a que era la otra pregunta que me habías hecho, lo de
costo-beneficio.
Lo del coste-beneficio análisis, perdón. El coste-beneficio análisis, soy consciente de ello. Cada país tiene un usuario y un nombre que normalmente lo suele tener la autoridad competente. Entonces, preguntar a las autoridades de vuestros países, las cuales deben de tener un usuario y un password, si no la tienen, que manden un email, ¿vale?, a la gente de la herramienta y les deben de mandar un usuario y una contraseña gratis. Pero tiene que ser la autoridad. Para el resto de usuarios es pagando.
Gracias.
De nada. Besito.
¿Algún otro comentario, alguna otra consulta? ¿Comentarios, consultas?
Sí, perdón.
Un día muy largo.
¿Tenemos la plantilla del volumen 3 del plan regional o todavía estamos trabajando en ella?
¿Me lo preguntas a mí?
Sí, por favor.
Ah, pues tuvimos una reunión con la oficina de SAM en la que vimos todas las mejoras que habíais propuesto. Muchísimas gracias por ellas, porque realmente me parecen que son muy buen feedback. Entonces, hemos añadido todas esas propuestas que vinieron del uso por parte de ustedes del volumen 3 en la región de SAM. Y entonces lo que vamos a hacer ahora es coger esa template en el estado que está y vamos a intentar aplicarla a unos cuantos estados que se ofrezcan a liderar este esfuerzo en la región de NAC. Para una vez que tengamos eso, pues publicarlo.
Vale, muchas gracias. Un abracito.
Un abrazo. Gracias, Nivia.
Gracias, Nivia. No sé si hay más comentarios, más consultas de los participantes. No sé, de los oficiales de la oficina NAC.
So, I want to thank Olga very much for her inputs, many lessons learned. For us at ICAO NAC office, as I mentioned in the introduction, what is important is that we can identify the transfer that we are making towards a performance-based environment. In the example that Olga was making in the conversation with Uruguay, you had the opportunity to see different opportunities for implementation. But at the end, what we are looking is for an outcome, an impact that you're gonna be able to measure that. So many times states, and in particular, when we get regional agreements toward implementation, move forward to implement some elements that at the end they're not going to give you any benefits. So what we are expecting is that what we choose, what we are focused now is in the what is it that we want to achieve. The how, we need to follow the principles of these exercises to agree at a regional level and at an individual state level on the how. What are we going to achieve that? And that's basically, I guess this is going to be the first of many sessions on this. I really would like for Olga, maybe in other opportunities to divide in small groups and do go over the exercise, play a little bit more with the tool. So maybe with the smaller teams for different subregions, at least for the CAR region, we would like to, make more questions to Olga that would allow for us to play with the tool. But our goal is also to try for the regional groups for implementation to move forward to use this as a reference, as a valid reference for the plans. We talk a lot about the performance-based environment, as I had said before. But when we go to address performance-based questions, we want to think in the same way that we already did in the past, to say, no, we already agreed this, and now everything needs to be put into question regarding to this, that we really understand the tool that we are gonna be using, and that we move forward with a new way to work. So again, thank you very much to Olga and our college of the SAM regional office as well.
Thank you, Adrian. I think it's very beneficial for everybody, and we are actually taking advantage of everybody's experience with this. So thanks a lot on my side.
Jorge, Francisco, queria solo ressaltar alguns pontos e para os estados. Esta tarefa de planeamento, de planear seus sistemas, é uma tarefa que deve ser, como já mencionado aqui, grupo multidisciplinário. É muito importante saber que não é uma pessoa ou duas pessoas que vão desarrollar estes estudos e planificar e fazer todos os análises. Então, alguns estados tomam isso como programa, não? Como programa dentro de vários projetos. Então, este é ponto muito importante. E utilizar a ferramenta. Já podem utilizar, está disponível, não? E quando se começa a utilizar, que realmente aparecem as dúvidas, e afortunadamente temos pessoas que estão dando respostas para as dúvidas em las oficinas regionais, também em La Sede de Montreal. Olga é uma pessoa muito acessível e normalmente toma algún tiempo a veces porque tiene muchas atribuciones, pero siempre da una respuesta de una manera muy gentil. Entonces, es muy importante que las autoridades, que ustedes, si no son autoridades, lleven a las autoridades y empiecen a conformar, ¿no?, sus grupos en cada país y con esta idea. Hay que planificar nacionalmente, porque los planes regionales son la armonización de sus planes nacionales. Ustedes que conocen su espacio aéreo, conocen sus inversiones, conocen, ¿no? Es muy importante que la planificación nacional de servicios de navegación aérea esté conectada a los planes nacionales de desarrollo, ¿no? Y todo lo que se piensa como Estado. Entonces, esos son los puntos que quería remarcar, que fueron mencionados, y lleven la necesidad de entrenar a sus autoridades, y ahí ellos pueden convocar paquetes específicos, ¿no? Y pueden realmente tomar providencias y planear esos presupuestos y todo más que son necesarios para avanzar en estas implantaciones. Y un punto muy importante también es tener lo que es necesario ya implementado. Hay cosas que ya son de bloques que ya pasaron. Voy a mencionar un caso, IMHS, que es el servicio de mensajería que reemplaza el sistema de mensajería anterior, que era la red FTN. Ese ya es un bloque que ya fue, ya todos los habilitadores están, ¿no?, ya disponibles, y hay que avanzar en eso porque eso es habilitador para otros bloques, ¿no? Entonces, el swing, la automación que va a venir, depende de un nuevo sistema de mensajería. Eso es solo un ejemplo, ¿ok? Gracias.
Please allow me to add something to the comment by Francisco. And we need to also to send the message to our states that we cannot underestimate the planning. This is a lot of work that you need to dedicate to. And then sometimes we have a lot of experience, operational experience, but we need to focus a little bit more on planning. This has a significant impact in the investment and the output of your air navigation system. So we need to put significant time to this, dedicate, as Francisco very well mentioned, to gather work groups adequately represented and put time and effort into planning, into understanding these concepts. So this is something that we are, I guess, both regional offices and individually, we're going to keep working on, but we need to stress that importance as well.
Okay, I need to go to another meeting, unfortunately, but if there is any question, any further question for me, Jorge, just send me an email. You know, everybody knows that I, as Francisco was saying, I reply late, but I try to reply to everybody. So if I do not do so, just send me a reminder and an email and I will do so, okay? Muchísimas gracias por la oportunidad y nos vemos pronto. Un saludo a todos.
Gracias.
Muchas gracias, muchas gracias, Olga. Muchas gracias a todos.
Gracias.
Si no hay más comentarios, si no hay más consultas, agradecemos a todos por la participación. Un agradecimiento muy especial a Olga. Bueno, Barbados, do you want to do some comments or question? Donna?
Yes, I just want to say thank you to the presenter for inviting us to the meeting on behalf of the Barbados contingent. It was rather informative and, well, it gives us the impetus to go and review our global air navigation plan as well. And we also look forward to the smaller groups that Eddie referred to. And it was a, you know, very informative session this morning. Thank you again.
Thank you.
Olga, antes de retirarte, quisiera pedirle a todos los participantes, antes de cerrar la sesión, si pueden prender las cámaras para sacar la foto oficial de la reunión, por favor. Okay. Dorita, son cinco paneles que hay que sacar. Dorita, ¿estás ya? ¿Cómo vas a sacar la foto, Dorita?
Yo voy avanzando, si gustas.
Ok.
Jorge, ¿te puedo hacer una preguntita? Los que se van activando para la foto.
Adelante. Adelante.
Dijo adelante.
República Dominicana.
Sí, me das un segundito.
Aris. Para
abrir. Sí. En el año 2000, dame un segundito para buscar la. En el año 2014 se firmó la declaración de Puerto España, donde se establecen algunas metas de navegación aérea y de seguridad operacional. Prácticamente todas esas metas estaban para cerrarse entre el 2016 y 2017, pero hay una o dos que entiendo estaban para el 2020. ¿Esa meta ya la absorbe el GAMP?
¿Es para mí la pregunta?
Bueno, cualquiera que tenga conocimiento para aclararme eso.
Si me permites, Olga, en efecto, sí, claro. Existe la declaración de España, de Puerto España, y la declaración de Bogotá. En general eran todos plazos para la finales de 2016, no recuerdo mal, en el caso de, por lo menos, de la declaración de Bogotá. Pero no es en sí misma, esas declaraciones no son en sí mismas planificaciones. Las planificaciones se realizan a través del documento ANI de Caribe y del SAMPIBIP y los programas y proyectos de GREPECAS. El contexto de la declaración de Bogotá y declaración de Deporte España impulsaron muchísimo las implantaciones, pero en realidad fueron acuerdos para sustentar, digamos, mejores avances. Ahora estamos entrando ya en el mundo de los KPI, indicadores mucho más puntuales que estos acuerdos entre autoridades de aviación civil. Espero haber respondido a su pregunta.
Sí, muchísimas
gracias. Só para agregar, creo que foram mais compromissos das autoridades, não?
Em realidade, compromissos.
Foram compromissos
estabelecidos. Que... sí. Ok. Tomamos a foto e deixemos que pueda salir ya Olguita, porque tiene el
problema. Por favor, no escriban nada en el chat mientras se quita la foto.
Bien, muchas gracias.
Gracias.
Gracias. Gracias a todos.
Gracias.
Muchas gracias por todo. Bye, buen día.
Buen día.
Muchas gracias a todos. Gracias a todos.
Gracias, abrazo.
Nos vemos oportunamente.
Gracias. Chao, Dorita.
Gracias, buena semana.
Gracias.
Por el soporte. Gusto,
que estén bien.
Gracias.
Como Dora. Siempre el equipo. Dorita, Carla, gracias.
Gracias, saludos.
Un gusto a todos, saludos, hasta luego. Gracias.
Gracias.
Dorita, poneme una foto que hoy no tengo cámara.
Señor. Sí. Live meeting.
Muy agradecido a las intérpretes, no sé si ya salieron todas, pero le agradecemos mucho su trabajo, excelente trabajo, lo que han realizado. El éxito de esta taller en gran parte se debe al trabajo de las dos, del intérprete y de la intérprete. Muchas gracias por el apoyo.
Gracias.
Muchas gracias también, realmente ha sido muy provechoso.